Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show, 918-460-KMOD. You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Listen online, the website that rocks, KMOD.com. Past shows are available on iTunes. Search under BMS. Listen with your cell phone. Get the iHeartRadio app, available from the app store of your cell phone provider. More on that at iHeartRadio.com. And we're on Facebook, Facebook.com/BMMS69. That's where you can hang out with us each and every day. Good morning, Lindsay.
Good Friday to you, Corbin.
Good morning, Gimpy.
Well, good morning.
We've got tickets to Star Set we're going to give away. See, Star Set is playing KMOD's Spring Fling Thing. That's on April 13th at the Tulsa Theater. Tickets available at TulsaTheater.com. We'll do some Taser Time trivia. We've got Willy Nilly. Friggin' A Friday, of course. Someone's going to win beer. We want to know, what's something you've learned in the last week? What's something you've learned in the last week? If you have an answer of nothing, don't waste the energy on your thumbs. So BMMS and whatever that is to 82945, case Keystone Light could be yours.
Boom.
And we're qualifying people for See 'Em All 2024. And good dude, Slut Puppy, just got qualified. Longtime listener of the show. He's now in the running to see every concert KMOD is a part of, including VIP Week in Rocklahoma tickets, which I know is what he's really in for.
Oh, yeah.
Make sure you listen every hour with us and then throughout the day with Mel and J-Rod. It's all from Yuengling, America's oldest brewery and Tulsa's rock station, 97.5 KMOD. Lindsay, are you tough? Like, would you consider yourself, if you were describing yourself, would you say you're a tough person? Like, you got grit, like you're tough.
I think so. I think I have a pretty strong threshold for pain.
Okay. Gimpy, would you describe yourself as tough? Yeah. Have grit?
Tough enough, yeah.
Right. How much tough we talking?
Yeah, right.
What's the situation? What day of the week is it? Yeah, I would consider myself to have a little tenacity, yeah, right? Mm-hmm. And have some grit.
Yeah.
What animal do you think you could beat in a fight?
Okay. Mm.
The animal world is your oyster, so sure. Pick one. Which one are you confident you could kick its ass?
A squirrel.
Oh, okay.
I doubt that. I highly doubt that. They call them squirrely little bitches for a reason.
Listen, I applaud you, Gimpy, because I think a lot of people do this. Mm-hmm. They jump to a small animal.
Right.
Not realizing
they're quick.
There's literally a name. Their name is also a word used to describe your ability to not get hit.
Sure.
Right. Man, how they dart out in front of the car and then quickly turn around and hit the other way and not get hit.
Yeah.
Blows my mind.
Okay, so squirrel, Gimpy.
A goddamn manatee, bro. If I'm going to fight an animal, it's going to be the sea cow.
Okay. Okay.
Ain't so, nothing for me to whoop a sea cow's ass.
Don't. Don't ever do that again. I'm going with sloth.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Because they're sleep, slow moving.
And they sleep during the day.
Mm-hmm.
So sleepy.
It's like, I'm not fast, but I'm going to see that punch coming.
Mm-hmm. So here's my theory on the sloth, all right? I like where you're at. They sleep. They're nocturnal. Okay, and they seemingly are slow moving.
Yeah.
What if that is a defense mechanism for the sloth? Like when something approaches it, it's just slow moving. So they seem, you know, seemingly harmless. But when they ain't around, they're fast, mean little assholes with those giant claws.
Yeah, they're not. Can't what if.
I'm just
right?
saying.
It's what we know.
Uh-huh.
And we don't know any time that a sloth has suddenly become squirrely.
Cocaine sloth.
Cocaine sloth. I like it.
Right. It does just a little bit more activity.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, apparently there's been this list of animals that Americans think they could beat in a fight. And 72% said that they could beat confidently beat a rat in a fight.
No. Rats are dirty, man. Rats are dirty. Here's what I say that because they will do anything to survive. If that means chewing your Achilles tendon and bringing you down to their level, so then masses of them can swarm you and eat you alive, I'm good. I'm good on the rat, man.
Yeah, is it just you and one rat, or is it you and a gang of them?
Either way.
Yeah.
Either way, you got one, and they're fast. They're very nimble.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And next thing you know, you've got a goddamn rat in your pants running right on up there. Right?
I wish.
Fighting you on the dangling.
I'm out. I'm out on the rat fight.
Do you get a weapon?
Next one. No.
Yeah.
No, this is using your hands. Don't add. Mm-hmm. House cat. 69% believe they could tackle, followed by a goose that 61% think they could beat.
Yep.
I don't think so.
I'm with you, man. I'm with you. Especially geese.
Why do you think you could beat a goose?
Because you can grab a goose by the neck and then grab that bird and twist it and break its neck.
You obviously have never chased a goose.
Or been chased by a goose.
Or had been chased.
I mean, they are evil. That's why I tell my husband all the time, shoot them all. Kill them all. I can't stand geese.
Yeah,
they
I can't either.
They annoy the hell out of me.
We go over to the Bass Pro area for the Cinco de Mayo.
Yeah.
You know, from time to time. They've got the geese over there, and they are a-holes, man. And I get it. They're just trying to protect their eggs, protect their nest. Sure. But, man, they come out with their wings all spread wide the hell open.
Yeah. And they act like they own the roads.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he could beat a goose in a fight.
I'll tell you what. You stand at one end of the hall. I'll get a goose and put it on the other, and you stand your ground.
When my husband was a little boy, his grandmother took him to the zoo, and they had them, they just willy-nilly walk around the zoo, and he got chased by a goose, and she attacked that goose with her purse. And to this day, he still has that visual of her attacking the goose, hitting the goose with her handbag.
That's awesome.
Yes, yes. So it can be done.
Yeah, but you're using a weapon.
That is true. Yes.
Right. And like we got a text here, I could smoke a deer for sure.
Yeah,
in your Buick.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I don't. But you don't get that. This is a fisticuffs. Put up your dukes.
Right. Or ramming.
Yeah. You get no weapons. You get no cars. This is just bare knuckle boxing an animal of sorts. And I tell you what, deer. If you've seen when animals attack, remember those type of shows or whatever, I have seen a deer whoop a guy's ass. And I don't know if you know this or not. Lindsay probably knows it, but deer hooves are hard.
Yeah, yes. They're antlers.
And antlers, pointy.
And they're heavy. Mm-hmm. The whole animal's heavy.
Yeah, I could smoke a deer.
Yeah, a doe is not going to come at you. They're going to run from you. But a buck, if it's protecting, it'll come,
It's going to come and beat you with its feet, or it's going to try to hump you. One and two.
The other animal that Americans tend to think they could take on is a medium-sized dog. 49% feel sure about it. 23% are confident they would win against a large dog.
Oh, medium-sized dog, maybe. Large dog, I don't know.
Domesticated house dog, your dog? I believe that.
Mm-hmm.
Strange dog? Wild dog? No.
Some feral dog of sorts? Yeah, probably not.
Yeah. No, Cujo, of course, I think you're out the door. But
you know, I'm not even so sure about a house dog because some house dogs, they want to protect their family. They don't know you. They might go into defense mode.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, we're not talking about you misheard me. Your personal dog, mm-hmm. I think you could probably whip its ass.
Yeah, I don't know.
No, hear me out. Your personal dog, I think you could whip their ass because they're already trained to be submissive to you.
Right.
But if I go to your house and you have a dog, I'm confident that what you're saying applies.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This person texted in, I'm fighting a kangaroo. Good luck with that one, bro.
No kidding.
I've seen those videos too. And there's been plenty of people get their ass whooped by a kangaroo.
Yeah. The difference between a kangaroo and other animals is a kangaroo is like a cat.
Right.
They're willing to step up.
Absolutely. And they can. And they look jacked too. like working out in the gym 6 days a week.
They ripped. 17% believe they could win unarmed against a chimpanzee.
Mm-mm. No.
15% feel they would be able to beat a king cobra. And 14% say the same about a kangaroo.
Nope.
Few folks believe they could win against some dangerous animals, including a wolf, 12%, a crocodile, 9%, a gorilla or elephant or lion, 8%. Those people, whoever those eight, they've had to have been high.
Yeah.
Had to be. Where are they getting these people, this survey from? You know what I mean? I ain't taking on an elephant.
The largest land animal.
Absolutely.
On the planet, you're going to take on.
You get Please. Slapped with his trunk and you're done for.
Exactly.
Let alone get stomped on. You know, they rear back. They got all that weight and they bring it down on that 1 foot and bam.
Or you trip and fall, and then they just lay on you.
Right. And a chimpanzee, no effing way. Because why? There's been documented stories where chimps will rip you apart,
yeah,
literally, starting with your ears and then moving on to your testicles and then whatever the hell else they can get their little monkey hands on.
Remember the
on.
Lady that lost her face?
Yes.
Yeah.
Ripped her face plumb off.
And a lion is like a whole other thing.
Oh, yeah.
You, I will take this. You might have a chance against a lion during the day. You might. Because they're a nocturnal animal. So everything's on their side at that point.
Right.
But,
right.
But still.
Whew. Even then, when provoked during the day, I ain't messing with that. No lions, no tigers, no bears. Oh, my.
Did you see that photo recently? It wasn't a cobra, I don't think. It was one of the snakes in Florida. Mm-hmm. Had eaten a full-size alligator.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the pythons.
Yes,
yeah. Or something like that.
Yeah, the one that's really invasive down there. Mm-hmm. A full-size, like 6-7 feet long.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It was insane. And you think you're going to beat it? I watch people like try to, because I don't know why I like watching people with their pets and it attacking them, but I do. And
it's funny.
Especially ones like wild, super wild ones. And she had a snake and she reaches in and then she grabs it and the snake starts wrapping around her and she can't get her hand free.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a bite out of her hand and then it just starts wrapping and she can't get it loose. You have no idea, unless you are someone who trains, mm-hmm, to be put into panic situations and how to breathe,
right?
How to not overdo yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you're going to get your ass whooped.
Yeah.
This person texted in, I'm going to beat a bunny's ass.
Yeah,
well,
you will.
No, you won't, because they are fast. They won't let you catch up to them. There's extra points if you happen to run over a rabbit with a car because they are so quick.
Well, I think that's a good point. Is some animals, their defense mechanism is keep up.
Right.
And then when you can't keep up and you like, then they come and eat you.
Mm-hmm. I mean, look at that rabbit from Monty Python. Okay. Just attacked everybody. Left him in a bloody mess.
Somebody texted in a video of a dude decking a kangaroo to save his dog is one of my favorite videos. That is a great video, but that's one punch.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We're talking you both enter the cage. And only one of you gets to leave. That's what we're talking about. We're not talking about I'm trying to deter you to get you to move on. The idea is the animal is also knows the rule.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The animal's also, that's the thing about some people's argument in hunting is only one of you knows it's for death.
Mm-hmm.
And so the idea of you both being in there, kangaroo's like been training for months and is like, all right, I'm ready. Ding, ding.
Right.
No way.
Person says I'm destroying a house cat. I'd have plenty of scratches, but if it's four to the death, they have no chance. Maybe so.
I get that take too, because the idea, let's just say like a Pomeranian, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Or a Chihuahua. Like these are small dogs you feel like you can kick. But again, most of the time you're kicking those animals or you think you're kicking those animals in a time when they aren't suspecting it.
Right.
If you're both on the same page of it's time for death.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Hunger Games.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you may get a couple good licks in, but I think you're going to come out messed up a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. When you go to kick them, they're going to bite your pant leg and just hang on.
No, they'll just move out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I don't know if you'll be able to bite on your leg on the way by.
Right.
Yeah. Are they fighting me too? Yes. They're not going to sit there and take it. They've got a reputation to uphold as well.
You bitch ass house cat.
They know bitch duck.
All right. Lay there and take it.
Yeah. I was at like Walmart and get my groceries and they're like, hi, we're doing a little survey. I have good clean drinking water. I'm fine. No. We want to know, what animal do you think you could kick?
What?
I'm in. Let's do this.
Yeah.
Is that going to be on the Family Feud?
Right. In a survey.
Right. All right. We asked 100 people which animal you can kick its ass.
My ex-husband. All right. So it's Friggin' A Friday. What's something you've learned in the last week? BMMS and what that is to 82945. Got a case of Keystone Light we're going to give you. Plus, we're also qualifying people for CML 2024. Another chance to get qualified every hour with us. Be back. It comes as lawmakers in Oregon voted to end the ban on self-serve gas, and Governor Tina Kotek signed off on it, ending the state's 72-year ban. Gas stations across New Jersey have pushed for lawmakers to lift the ban, which has been in effect since 1949. They say self-serve gas would allow them to lower the price.
Absolutely, yeah. I wonder why that's crazy. That's crazy. I thought, you know, those days of somebody else pumping, having gas station attendants were pretty well over.
Yeah.
You know, I haven't seen one in forever.
There's one here in town.
Is there?
Yeah, Reed's over.
Oh, on, yeah, Reader's over there off of 15. Okay. But it costs you extra.
And of course it does.
I don't like it. Yeah.
Blank are coming to Jeopardy.
Nerds.
In there.
Right. Average people. There you go. The bottom of the class is coming to Jeopardy.
Right. Reruns.
Oh, I could see that. Like on old, like on a game show network or something. Playing the old episodes of the Jeopardy.
Oh, yeah. You
know, like the 80s and stuff like that. You know, so we still get our taste of Alex Trebek and that wonderful stash.
Mm-hmm. The fro, man.
Oh, yeah.
When the new season of Jeopardy premieres, there'll be some changes as the writer strike continues. During an interview on the Inside Jeopardy podcast, that's a thing, executive producer Michael Davies revealed that the show will use a combination of material from our WGA writers wrote before the strike, which is still in the database, and redeployed material from multiple seasons of the show. Mm. The new season will also have a second chance tournament showcasing players from the 2020-2021 season. Look for new episodes of Jeopardy to premiere in September.
Okay.
This strike is causing a lot of problems. I didn't know the writers wrote the stuff for game shows.
Mm. I didn't either, but I guess it kind of makes sense. Somebody's got to write it.
Yeah. So what are they going to do? That's why CBS is going to have Survivor.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to have Survivor, Amazing Race, and Big Brother on all at the same time.
Right, because those don't require writers.
Yes.
Huh.
Or actors.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
So they will have them. That's never happened before. And we watch all three of those. So, and they're on so much.
Mm-hmm.
It's, I don't know how we're going to keep up. That's a wife problem. Which makes it my problem. Almost half of Americans aren't eating enough blank. Almost half of Americans aren't eating enough blank.
Fruits and vegetables.
Green vegetables.
Red meat.
Oh, I think we are.
Pastries. Americans aren't eating enough pizza.
It's a movement I can get behind.
Italian pasta.
Let's see. Americans aren't eating enough tapioca.
Okra.
Pudding. No one would ever say that. Mm-hmm. Americans say they love apples, oranges, and bananas, but 43% admit it to not eating enough fruit even once a day, according to a new survey. It finds that 52% confess to not eating veggies on the reg. To get the nutrients they need, they may be missing. 51% drink at least one smoothie a week.
Wow. Huh.
How often do you eat vegetables, Lindsay?
Vegetables? Daily.
Okay, say more.
With dinner every day. It's
every day you have vegetables with dinner?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like a portion of vegetables, not like, hey, the pasta has tomatoes in it.
No, nope. We have a portion of either something. It's either a green bean, it's either Brussels sprouts, asparagus. Those are the three staples in our house.
Gimby?
Yeah, same thing every day.
Every day.
Every day. Every day. It's a protein, a meat of sorts. Okay. And then usually taters of some kinds, be it mashed taters or, you know, scallop potatoes, something to that effect. So meat, protein, carb, and then a vegetable every day. That's the three things on my plate. I have recently. I went to the store the other day. I was like, you know what? I haven't had fruit in a damn coon's age. So I went to town, you know, got a bag of grapes and some watermelons and, you know, other stuff like that.
I eat fruit every day. Mm-hmm. But as far as vegetables, if it's in the HelloFresh, yes.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But not, and maybe if we're grilling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I make it a point every time I get groceries to get like four or five things of frozen vegetables, whatever. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You said mashed potatoes, and I just don't count those as vegetables.
No, they're not. Raw potatoes or whatever, like a baked potato would be all right, but.
I mean, if you're going to count a baked potato, you should be able to count mashed potatoes, and you should be able to count French fries.
Okay.
Right? Because it's all potatoes.
Right, right. It just depends on how it's cooked or whatever. Yeah.
If you eat fried green beans, mm-hmm. You eating green beans?
Technically, but it's deep fried.
If I have fried mushrooms, that's not the question, isn't how they're made. If you have fried mushrooms, are you eating vegetables every day?
Absolutely. Mm. Absolutely, because you're still getting the vegetable that's inside that breaded goodness.
Yeah, but you're getting
again,
extra
it's not
calories.
Yes,
I guess.
But if you have broccoli and cheddar, you don't discount that you didn't eat broccoli.
Right, right.
True.
So, yeah.
Cover it in cheese sauce. Mm-hmm. Hardly good for you.
It is delicious, though.
True.
Last one. The age blank stopped being fun. The age blank stopped being fun.
Age blank. The age of 69. Giggity. Huh.
The age staying up late stopped being fun?
Okay. I mean, that doesn't make much sense, but okay.
I don't know.
The age gap.
Drinking too much? Or excessive partying?
Aged wine. Think of other things that are aged.
The age when blank stopped being fun. According to a question online, at what age did life stop being fun? Thousands of people have responded so far, and a lot of the answers are upbeat, with many saying they haven't reached that age yet. Some folks also say life didn't get fun until they got older, and some say it's never been fun.
Wow. Oh,
those poor people.
Lindsay, what's the age when life stopped being fun?
It hasn't stopped. I think it gets better.
Gimby?
It does. It changes. You know, it shifts, but it never stops being fun. It only stops being fun if you let it stop being fun. Like those people that say, it's never been fun. I was born and I've been miserable ever since. It's those people, right? So I'm with Lindsay. I don't think it ever stops.
For me, it's getting funner, more fun as I get older. But there's a scene in the new season of Reservation Dogs, and in it, the aunt is talking to one of the kids who had run away to California and came back. And in the scene, she talks to the kid about like, hey, you're expecting this other shoe to drop that you get older and things just suddenly change. Mm-hmm. She's like, that never happens. You're still the same person you were at 4. I'm still the same person I was at 12. The difference between those times is I just have a ton more baggage.
Right.
And that baggage weighs you down. Mm-hmm. And I was like, damn, that's truth. Two men hold driver hostage after delivery of cold kebabs. So a 14-hour standoff went down in the UK when two men held their delivery driver hostage after he, quote, failed at his job when their kebabs arrived late and cold and their salad was missing. Paul, I'm so hungry. Burton, 45, and Nathan, I'm with him, Turner, decided to live stream the whole thing on Facebook. Complaining to police about the shoddy driver. After a police negotiate to 82945. News quickies are stories you may have missed in the news. We cover them here and put a link on our Facebook page. But on Fridays, we do just the headlines. So let's get started.
It's time for news quickies, world news, local news, and news that just makes you say, what the f-? Now, here's Corbin, Gimpy, and Lindsay with what's going on. News quickies from the Big Man Morning Show at 97.5 KMOD.
Sheen customer shocked to find a vial of blood in dress delivery box.
What's the what? A what customer?
Sheen.
It's an online place like Wish or Temu, wherever you get
clothing company
stuff. Yeah. Experts say that fish full of antidepressants and cocaine after a sewage spill.
Oh, my goodness.
Cocaine fish coming soon to a theater near you.
New HIV cases linked to shuttered salon that offered vampire facials. For those who don't know what a vampire facial is, I implore you to go look it up. Mm-hmm. It is very bizarre.
Yeah. I think the Kardashians made it pretty popular.
Seen that movie.
Parents reserve park benches with threatening note for kids' birthday party.
Say again.
Parents reserve park benches with threatening note for kids' birthday party.
And I've been to birthday parties that are in public parks, and the bowing up that happens to try and protect your real estate is very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Come on, man. We're all just trying to do the same thing.
I reserved it online.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, I called the 800 number.
It's a public park.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Woman with severe food allergy lives on baby formula.
That would suck. That'd be awful.
There's no way the doctor recommends that.
Think she just did it on her own?
Yeah.
Possibly.
There's just not the right nutrients for an adult in that.
No. No, but I mean, I guess if you can't eat anything, because that's what it sounds like.
No. 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 Because even they make babies get off it at a certain point because they're not getting all the things they need.
Right.
And now there's things that you can do if you have food allergies that there's like actual doctor recommended things that you do. You eat those foods to help you be unallergic to them.
Mm.
Yeah, but those type of procedures take a lot of money and time.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And if she decided I'm done with doctors, this feels like she just made a choice.
Yeah.
That's what I'm thinking.
And maybe for attention.
I mean, possibly. Or maybe she's never felt, maybe she got some sort of trauma in her life, and that was the only time she ever felt safe, and so she's just resorted back to that.
Oh, God, she's reverted back all the way to the time she felt safe.
Oh, yeah. People that go through trauma do things to us that don't make sense, but to them, I just got to feel safe.
I can see reverting back like maybe a couple of decades or to your child or teenage years, but all the way to the infant stages. Ooh, it must have been some pretty traumatic stuff.
Yeah, remember, I know I keep going to this, but the triangle, if she felt like super chaos, she's going to do a super chaotic thing.
I guess you're right.
Hunter mistakes man for turkey, shoots him in the head, police say.
That's why you always wear orange.
That's right.
Yeah, or stand up.
Right.
Yeah.
And don't go while you're in the bush.
How do you mistake a man for a turkey?
Well, it's a jive turkey.
Yeah. Washington sheriff receives bizarre call from man asking if it's legal to hunt Sasquatch.
I mean, at least he's trying to get permission just in case.
Right.
You know, you don't want to get pulled over and you're like, what do you got back here? Oh, it's Bigfoot. Did you know it's illegal to hunt Bigfoot?
Mm-hmm.
And now here's your $50,000 fine.
Yeah.
Woman left with kidney damage after visiting salon. That sucks.
It's a weird place for hair.
Right.
Everest climbers will have to take their poop away with them as Nepal tries to address growing waste problem.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Clean up your dookie. Don't just leave it there.
I mean, there's a body here.
Yeah. But it's not his poop.
Yeah. There's a what's the documentary? And it talks about how that's become a tourist thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you do all this training and then you stand in line to go up to, it's insane.
I'm good on all that.
Yeah. Man buys entire house on Amazon for $26,000.
I have seen TikTok videos of something like that, where they bought a house off of Amazon and furnished it with everything that they could find on Amazon. And it was like an unfoldable house. It just came in and you just unfold it and put the pins in.
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom. But it didn't come with like electrical outlets. It did have a water hookup line, which I thought was interesting, but like it was missing a few things.
Yeah. I'm a little concerned with the term house and what we're using to describe that, because I saw a story just yesterday on the news that you can buy a house for cheaper than you can buy a car. And the house was like $26,000 or something. Mm-hmm. But, and then they did a tour of it. It's a shed.
Essentially.
That looks like a house. Mm-hmm. So it has no bathroom. It has no plumbing. It has no insulation. It has no electrical. That's not a house.
No.
Right, right. It's a roof over your head. And yeah, it's out of the elements for sure.
Yeah.
But listen, home is where you make it.
I think for it to classify as a home, it has to have indoor plumbing.
Absolutely.
Yes.
At minimum.
Absolutely. You could deal without electricity. You know, Amish have been doing it for years.
Yeah. And I think it has to have some sort of deviation that this is a certain spot of the home for something.
Mm-hmm.
Right, like so a like living room, bedroom.
Bathroom.
Right.
Yeah, otherwise it's just, then what's a shed?
Right. Mm-hmm. It's a home that's not a home yet. It's a home that doesn't know it's a home yet.
Yeah. Which begs the question, is a she shed or a man cave a home?
No.
I mean, if you get divorced and she kicks you out of the house, it could be.
It's your home away from home.
Right. Kids are sniffing nutmeg to get high.
Ew.
Whatever works.
Yeah, right.
There's no way that works.
I think there's only one way to find out.
Not
we had a nutmeg around here. I'll do it. I'll
yeah,
do it.
Of course you would.
I would think it would burn.
Just for right, because cocaine's just so awesome.
Yeah.
Cocaine's more of a pleasure thing. Right. I don't like the effects. I just like the flavor.
Yeah, right. I just like the way it smells.
Deceased man's body found in the New York water supply after 25 days. Authorities declare the water safe for consumption.
Oh, no.
Yes, it's safe for consumption.
Again, not it.
Really, the thing that I think you both went over it is the amount of chemicals they put in it for it not to be a concern.
That's true. Good point.
Right.
Study says parents feel shame over how they feed their babies.
Maybe they should. I don't know how they're feeding their babies, but if they feel shameful, if you feel a certain way, I think this, if you feel a certain way, like you feel it's right or you feel it's wrong or you feel shame or guilt, chances are those feelings are right. And you should probably change some things.
Oh, I don't know if that's true.
If you feel shame, if you do something and you feel shame while doing it or guilt while doing it or afterwards, I think that feeling was right and what you did was wrong. And you know what you did was wrong, but you did it anyway for whatever silly reason.
Hmm. Okay. I'll go with that. I think you're choosing to feel shame.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
And I think that if you're feeling, you should be way before that and go, what's the right thing I need to do?
Mm-hmm.
And just do that.
Right.
Then you don't have to worry about shame.
Right, of course. But
shame is another thing you get from other people.
Mm. Ooh. I don't know about all that. I think you can have self-shame. I think your inner conscience tells you, like, what you did just now was wrong. And shame on you for doing it. You see what I'm saying? And then people will either, A, ignore it, or B, beat themselves up for it.
Yeah, but only the people that know, right, mm-hmm. are the people you tell. So if you're like, okay, let's say I took a box of tissues from here.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, oh, I shouldn't have done that.
Mm-hmm.
And feel the shame as you're describing it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then I tell you, and mm-hmm. then you're like, he took a box of tissues.
Right, right.
So you're feeling shame at that point. Or you go, hold on, or mm-hmm. you go, hey, I took this box of tissues. I shouldn't. I put it back. And you correct your path.
Yeah.
If you stay on it.
Mm-hmm.
Then that's all on you.
Absolutely, yes. But you felt the shame in stealing the tissues, so you put them back. You felt that guilt. Your inner consciousness felt that guilt.
Right, you're choosing to go down that path.
Yes, absolutely. Now, if you took the tissues and then you felt the shame, but for whatever reason, you told me, you just felt like you had to come clean and told me that you stole tissues and you feel bad about it, and then I say, ah, ha, ha, well, he stole whatever. That's me just validating and justifying the feelings that you had.
No way, because you just said yesterday people's opinions don't matter. But if you do that and you've corrected your path, you shouldn't feel shame because you corrected it.
Absolutely. Right. I'll agree with you on that.
So in this headline, in my opinion, they're saying they feel shame because they're still doing it. Mm. If you feel like it's wrong, stop.
Right. Mm-hmm. I'll agree with you on
that's,
that
one. I think we're saying the same thing in that regard.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Shame, for shame.
But using your feet? Even then, I'm like, what if you don't have hands?
Right.
Right, right.
Man put in coma with a 4% survival chance thanks to an ingrown growing hair.
Dude, yeah.
Ingrown pubes sent him into coma.
Yeah, because he wanted to shave it, make it look bigger.
And now you're in a coma and you might die.
U.S. rep apologizes for using racial slur at her hearing. He says it was inadvertent. Sure. When you find out the word.
Sure was.
How do you not know?
Exactly. A groom leaves his wedding early to go to the bar with his friends.
I mean, if the party sucks, let's get out of here.
If she's being a bitch.
Right.
Listen, I'm going to have to put up with this broad for the rest of my life. Let's get out of here and go grab a drink, shall we?
Man, we're so happy for you. Let's go next door or to the hotel lobby.
That's fair.
Would still be a bar, still left to go to the bar. Uh-huh. Isn't that far?
Make it sound like you drove across town.
Yeah, it makes it sound like he was like they got in an Uber, right. Which maybe they did. Uh-huh. I don't know. Also, it didn't say she didn't go with him.
Right.
If she goes with him, is that okay, Lindsay?
Okay.
If she goes with, it's fine.
Yes, I agree. Mm-hmm. If she turns around and is like, have you seen my new bride, my groom? Yeah,
where's my husband?
Then that's a whole other thing.
We got to cut the cake. Right. He wouldn't see my
That's
husband.
A good point, too, is if it's over.
Right.
Yeah. Our first dance. It's time for the first dance. Where's my husband?
Right. She's already a nag that he's like, oh, God.
Yeah.
Take me to the bar.
Yeah.
I'm having regrets. Okay, let's go.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, go ahead and be.
Woman claims her ex stole her toilet after a breakup.
It's a weird thing to steal.
I mean, typically, sometimes you get back together with somebody because it feels familiar. So
right. I'll show her. She won't be able to use the bathroom after me.
So many jokes there. Yeah. Right. Lawmakers proposed legislation banning chemtrails.
Oh, no.
People are losing their minds. Last one, Lindsay.
Oh, okay. Idaho man drinks, this is for you, Gimpy. Idaho man drinks a liter of lemon juice in record time.
Yeah, I'm good and all.
There's
that.
No way that's good for you.
No.
Nope. All well, that acidity.
Yeah,
a
that's
liter.
True.
The acid on your teeth.
Yeah, good point.
Can somebody give me a baby real quick? Just the thought of it.
Psychologists say Britain is full of real vampires, zombies, and werewolves.
Probably. West Virginia governor signs law removing marital assault exemption.
They're married. I mean, they can't do.
My wife, if I want to hit her.
Mm-hmm.
I want to rape her. It's fine.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
But not anymore.
Yeah.
We're solving problems in West Virginia. All right. All these stories are on our Facebook page, facebook.com/BMMS69. What's something you've learned in the last week? Text it to us because we're giving away beer when we come back.
If you've ever put together a swing set in the last 5 years, it shows up and you're like, okay. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I could do this. And then on day two, you're like, we'll put that on later.
Right. Kids don't need a swing, do they?
Yeah.
Nah.
I think the monkey bar sat in my garage for a good year.
They're not going to be able to reach up there and grab it anyway.
Right, exactly. Do you think Mima was a bad person, abusive, maybe?
Are you justifying it? Are you implying that if she was, then she probably should be dismembered?
No. But would she have to be for it to be like...
You brought it up.
Okay.
You brought it up. You tell me.
Well, I look at Dexter, like the show Dexter. It was like he was almost like the good bad guy because he was taking out bad people.
Oh, Dexter was a horrible person.
Oh, see, I looked at him as a good bad guy. He was taking out bad people.
Like a Robin Hood sort of thing.
Yes.
That instead of robbing the rich and giving to the poor, we're just killing bad people.
Uh-huh.
Jack the Ripper is another one, killing the whores of the world.
Yes.
If you think that's bad.
If, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I Dexter was not a good person.
I thought so. I thought he was good.
But he was hurting people. He was killing people for minor things, not huge infractions.
Some of them
bumped into me at the grocery store.
Yeah.
No,
yeah. Some of them, no. Sure, but not all of them.
Oh, he wasn't doing it for bumping into
How
me at the grocery
store.
Dare
you take the last bagel at work?
I've got the longest running game shows in television history.
Fun.
You want to guess one?
Jeopardy.
Jeopardy's on here.
Yeah. Wheel of Fortune.
Wheel of Fortune, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So the Price is Right.
Price is Right, of course.
Okay, so those are the three basics. What about Press Your Luck?
No.
Yeah.
So Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Really?
22 years. Password, 23 years.
The pyramid?
What's my line? 24 years. Pyramid, 25 years. Let's make a deal, 35 years.
Wow.
Now, does that count? Because it wasn't 35 years consecutive. It was
right.
It was the Monty guy for a while, and then they brought it back with Wayne Brady. So I guess mashing together works.
Yeah.
I feel like it should be consecutive, like Price is Right, Wheel of Fortune, and Jeopardy. Those are all consecutive years.
Yeah, I think if you work at KMOD and then take a break and come back, you get X number of years.
Okay.
Right?
Alrighty then.
Family Feud, 40 years.
Okay.
Wheel of Fortune, 48 years. Jeopardy, 54 years. This show I've never heard of because it's in another country. Des Chérifs et de Lettres.
Sure. Easy
for Numbers and Letters, 56 years. It's still on today. Price is Right, 60 years.
So that's the longest. Price is Right.
Price is Right, yeah.
Wow.
Is the longest one. Or is it going to be a thing that comes out like it did with Bob Barker that he had to kind of step away because
he owed
he like a miscusi.
Oh, yeah. I didn't think about that. Yeah. Well, it was a different time then.
Right. changes. empathy towards humans.
Right.
60 years, a long time, though,
yeah.
For a game show.
Yeah, for sure. It just makes me wonder how long those are going to be on. Are they going to keep doing it? Are they going to revamp it, make it different so they can keep that name going? Because really, that's all that they're – I mean, people are going because of the name. People were watching because of the name, because they watched it growing up, you know. Everybody knows that when you're sick and you're staying home from school, you're watching The Price is Right.
Yeah. You know? I think shows like Price is Right is a different game show, obviously, than like Jeopardy or Wheel, because they have to technologically evolve.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They have to evolve the show and the games.
Right.
You can have some classics, but you've got to introduce new games on Price is Right because technology changes and people's understanding of things changes.
That makes sense.
Wheel of Fortune, it's spin a wheel, earn points. It's now, how they derive the letters and things like that, or on Jeopardy, can obviously change.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, it's the same game.
Yeah. There's no need to change it.
Tic-tac-toe, celebrity tip, whatever, doesn't last because you get annoyed. You get annoyed with the... Just because you're famous doesn't mean you're awesome.
Right. Yeah.
Hollywood Squares.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
And some of these other shows. That's why I like Pyramid, and like it runs its exhaustion level.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they don't do just Celebrity Wheel of Fortune. You want to see people that are like, quote unquote, you win.
Right. It gives you hope and a chance that you could be on that show someday and you could win that money.
The number of people that are like to know someone to be on Wheel of Fortune is rare. Think about all the times they come through and recruit people. And then how many people from here actually get on the show? Not very many. If you think about it. So where do those people come from? Well, they recruit people. Some are up and coming actors. Like they tried because they have to fill it. Lindsay's been tried to be on game shows before. One of the hardest parts about being on a game show is that you have to fly out on your own, put yourself up, and you might get on the show.
Right. They don't pay for you to be out there until you finally make the final cut.
And if when you're on the show, you might just get the minimum, which is like $1,000 now or something like that, which you're like, that's a lot. It is a lot. Not after hotel and airfare and expenses.
In California. Right.
In anywhere.
Yeah.
You go to any hotel, it's you're not gonna, even if you're gonna stay at the Comfort Inn.
Yeah.
Right.
And if you are, it's still $200. You're there a week. That's $1,000.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter where it's at. You ain't staying at the Sunnyside Inn with the satellite dish painted yellow.
Right. With all the crackheads and whores.
Well, I mean, you can get that anywhere, any hotel, right? I saw this story circulating today about TikTok doctors warning the number one position for penile fractures. Number one, 50. I want to make sure I get that. I would hate to fumble this. It's the most dangerous sex position, according to science, the cause of 50% of penile fractures. 50.
That's a lot.
So of all the penile fractures that happen, half are because of this sex position. Mm-hmm. What do you think, Lindsay?
Doggy style.
Okay, Gimby.
I am going to say it is the reversed cowgirl.
It is the reverse cowgirl,
which is my favorite by far.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes, all of them are good.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know.
Even plain old vanilla is good.
Yeah. Yeah. The line of great is pretty thin from a guy standpoint.
Right. I mean, I guess it kind of makes sense because they're not looking and paying attention, but are you really looking at me?
Good morning. It's the Big Man Morning Show, 918-460-KMOD. It's Friday. That means beer. Friggin' A Friday. Keystone Light is up for grabs. Case of it. We just want to know what's something you've learned in the last week. BMMS and what that is to 82945. Patrick is on the line. Hey, Patrick, how are you?
Hey, good morning, guys.
What's something you've learned in the last week?
Yes. Yeah, so apparently a leaking toilet can raise your water bill like more than quadruple it.
Whoa.
Yeah. Is it the flapper?
Yeah, the flapper, the stem, the whole thing, you know, it's just kind of old, hadn't been done in a while. So no, there I was sitting on my couch, you know, paying bills, logged into my water utility account, and normally it's not over like $100 or so, and yesterday it was like nearly $400.
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
If you...
I called him up, asked a couple questions, and yeah, my usage was like 15,000 gallons. I thought that was astronomical. But good news is I can submit a like usage anomaly thing, and they'll give me like the money back on my bill.
Wow. Yeah, they're pretty understanding in most cases, so that's cool. There's a device called a flume, and it attaches to your water meter, and it will let you know when there's a leak in somewhere.
Flume.
Yep. They sell them on Amazon. It's very easy to install. It's got a battery. They don't pay me. I use one. It works awesome. I can check it at any time to see if water's running through the meter.
Yeah. Thanks. Good luck, man.
Yeah. Dude, well, we're going to hook you up. It isn't as good as water, I guess, but it may result in the same problem. Go ahead, Gimpy. Go ahead and tell him exactly what he's going to get.
Learning little things like that just got you a case of Keystone Light. Live smooth. Back to you, Corbin.
Hang in line, Patrick. Gimpy's got to get your info and have a fantastic weekend.
Thanks, guys. You too.
All right, buddy.
A standout college athlete is on the fast track to represent our country in the Summer Olympics. USA Basketball announced yesterday that Caitlin Clark has been selected as one of 14 players to participate in a training camp next week in Cleveland.
Hooray!
The roster includes 13 current WNBA players, along with Clark, who is still playing for Iowa in the Sweet 16 of the NCAA Women's Basketball Tournament. The full Stars and Stripes roster features last season's WNBA MVP, Brianna Stewart, and last year's top overall draft pick, Aaliyah Boston. The opening ceremony of the Paris Olympics takes place on July 26th. And there's your Balls to the Wall Sports. I'm Lindsay at 97.5 KMOD.
Balls to the Wall Sports is powered by Miller Lite. The original, like a lot of breaks, like if you broke your foot, you just don't do it. You just have to be careful. You still have to walk
on it.
The cast. Yeah. Oof.
Right.
Not something I'm signing up for.
Right.
And having it removed. Pass. Hard pass.
Right. Where they break out.
Soft pass.
Yeah. It won't cut you. Mm-hmm. Not taking a chance there, Doc.
Teen arrested for setting hotel fire after fighting with mom. This also comes out of Florida, Ocala, Florida, where I guess a 16-year-old girl got in a fight with her mom at like 3:30 in the morning. And then goes down into the lobby and sets a sofa on fire. So the police and the ambulance and the fire trucks, everybody comes out, all these emergency crews or whatever. All 320 residents of the hotel, all the guests were evacuated at 3:30 in the morning. So the firefighters came in and they're battling through the smoke-filled lobby. And they find the fire, the source of it. The couch is on fire. They put it out with their little water can. They say that the damages cost a couple of $100,000. to this couch, and the wall that was behind it totally scorched, burnt up. Pictures are on our Facebook page. They ended up arresting the girl. They didn't say what the girl and the mom were fighting for over, and they didn't say what led to, you know, her wanting to set the couch on fire. My guess is probably just angry teen and probably had some alcohol involved in there somewhere. That's just my theories on it. Nonetheless, they went ahead and arrested her for arson, and the investigation continues.
So many things on this.
Mm-hmm.
They don't let you get your luggage. Like, you went out of the hotel, and then they're like, you can't go back in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you got to go find a place without your stuff.
Right.
Wallet, probably.
Right.
Credit cards, probably.
Maybe your phone.
And so all you're in is your skirt, you know. Your tidy whities or whatever.
So you're talking about 320 guests that were evacuated. They did let them all go back in. All the guests were allowed to go back into their room and go back to sleep after it was all said and done.
I'm shocked by that because the sprinkler system has gone off,
but just
and it flooded the floor,
the lobby area though. Just the first floor and that lobby area. Anybody
still feels like danger, Will Robinson.
Nine. Oh, I totally get you. Smoke damage, smoke inhalation, whatever. I was surprised that they let them all go back in as well, but that's what they said.
Dude, I was unaware that sprinkler systems in a building go off by floor.
Yeah, I thought it was all automatic all at one time. Everywhere.
Yeah, maybe this is a different one, but the story did say that they let all 320 guests or everybody that was evacuated go back to their room later on that morning, probably about 5:30 or so. Still, 3:30 in the morning, you woke up, you're probably on vacation.
Sure.
You gotta evacuate. Everybody go meet in the parking lot over there by the fourth
Bob Evans
street light. Yeah. Right. Exactly. And then you're waiting there for hours. Yeah. After they get everything cleaned up, you know,
smoke fills the whole place.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And they're like, you can go back. I'd probably be like, okay, I'm gonna go get my stuff and I'm gonna check out and go find another place. And then we'll deal with reimbursement after this.
All right. Then the other thing I was thinking about, your kid does this. What do you do?
What's the punishment?
Right, right. We'll deal with this when we get home.
How old was the girl?
16.
Yeah. Like, what do you do?
You're grounded.
No screens.
Right. She's 16 and went to jail for arson. So chances are this parent or the parents are going to be like, well, she went to jail and she's being charged. And they're probably going to take out the couple $100,000 worth of damage out of her
allowance.
That's
a whole roll. Yeah, right.
Right.
It feels too late. Like, yeah, all right. She's
so give up. Okay. Eaten. Give up on your kid. Okay.
No. I'm not saying that.
You're a lost cause.
You said it's too late.
Why don't you go live on the streets with the rest of the crackheads?
No, but I mean, like, it's too late to be like, you're grounded for, you know what I mean? Like,
well, typically punishments come after the infraction.
Sure, but she's in jail.
It'd be weird to ground your kid like you're a precog or something for something that hasn't happened yet.
She's in jail.
I don't know what you did yet, but you're grounded. I know you're going to do something. You're grounded.
I hope jail kind of wakes her up a bit.
Well, she's not going to jail.
She did. They arrested her.
But she went to juvie.
Right.
Okay.
And she probably may not spend a whole lot of time
Which is an education system.
Right.
I mean, there's probably going to be big time fine. She's going to have to go to court.
Her parents will pay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She will not be paying. That's what I'm saying. Like, she is going to be released probably to their.
Yeah. She'll be paying
supervision.
Back.
Mm-hmm.
She's my kid.
No, she won't be paying back.
If she's my kid, she is.
No.
She's going to be working it off. Hard labor.
For 40 years?
Busting rocks in the backyard.
This isn't you bought her an iPhone.
Right.
Ka-chink.
This is, as Gimpy said. If not two commas, it is definitely 100,000.
Mm-hmm.
She would be paying back forever. Mm-hmm.
You owe me every paycheck for the rest of your life.
Well, that makes no sense either.
When you retire, I want your retirement. I want your 401k. Yeah.
See what I'm saying? Like, it just creates all these questions.
Two Subway employees shot over too much mayo.
Okay. I was like, sandwich or?
Yes. In Atlanta, police responded to a shooting at a Subway location inside of a Circle K. Reportedly, a customer became irate when too much mayonnaise was squirted onto his sandwich. That's when he allegedly opened fire, hitting two female employees, one of which was fatally wounded, and the other is in serious condition. The store's owner says a third employee fired back at the unnamed gunman.
What?
Yeah, but he missed.
A third employee. That means the employee had a gun.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, by God, we got to save them sandwiches somehow, Corbin.
Yeah. The suspect is in custody. Police said that the woman was killed was 26 years old. A 24-year-old employee was shot in front of her 5-year-old son. She's the one that's in critical condition. The woman was hit twice after she pushed her son out of the way under the counter to keep him from being hurt. The co-owner of the Subway said that a third worker had definitely shot at the gunman. He missed, but at least he put up a little fight, he said. Atlanta police officer said that this was a case of someone with a gun who didn't know how to resolve conflict without resorting to violence. They did not release the identity of the worker who was killed because they were still waiting for family members to be informed, but said both of the employees were young women who had just started at the location about 3 weeks ago. And the customer had been in the Subway location before without ever having an incident. The interim chief of police said so far arguments are the majority cause of homicides this year in Atlanta.
There's a lot going on in this story.
Boy, I tell you.
Your 5-year-old kid was there?
Yeah.
That's what I thought was bizarre. Okay. I get it. You got to go to work. You can't find a babysitter, but.
Or can't afford one.
Or I was thinking too, or maybe she was going to get off in like 20 minutes and, you know, maybe the dad dropped the child off.
No,
and...
no, that's also not okay.
Yeah, I know.
That's a weird, it's a weird thing for the 5-year-old to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Two, another employee had a gun on him.
Yeah.
The other thing too with Subway is they're everywhere.
Right.
There was a time that I believe there were more Subways than McDonald's and Starbucks and Dunkin' Donuts and all that. Like they were the most widely dispersed chain.
Yeah, especially for sub sandwiches. Faux show. They were like, they had the corner market there. But then some other places started coming
I think
out.
They're still pretty high up on the list.
You think so?
Absolutely. They're ever. You go anywhere, there's a Subway.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Anywhere.
Inside, you know, so gas stations and stuff.
It's not like a Chick-fil-A, right? Like, you go, there are towns that just don't have Chick-fil-A's. I would bet almost every town has a Subway sandwich shop.
And if you're putting too much mayonnaise on mine, I'm giving you a tip. If I don't have to ask for it.
Here's the deal. You can tell them to stop anytime because you're sitting there watching them make your sandwich. You see how much of everything that they put on. You could have been like, whoa, 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 dial it back on the mayonnaise, man.
Or you can say light mayo. Or
right, but what's light mayo?
Light on the mayo.
Yeah, but how much is light? Your light and my light are not the same.
Yeah.
And I'm the artist here.
All right. These are the most popular sandwich chains in America. Okay. This is what it says. Blimpy. Have you ever had a Blimpy?
Yeah.
I have, but it's not most popular.
Mm-hmm.
It's the most locations.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Cause I can name my favorite sandwich shop, but it's not everywhere.
Right.
And I would wager the majority of people in this town have never eaten at it. Mm-hmm. Right. So, you can't go with most popular. You have to have which sandwich shop has the most locations.
Ah, largest sandwich chain in the U.S. Oh, here we go. Fun. This is as of 2020, so it's a couple of years old.
Uh-huh.
But it says largest sandwich chain, so does that quantify
I think so,
as it could be?
Sure.
Okay. Continue to the site. Subway comes in at number 6.
Oh.
It has their rankings on
here. What's number 1?
I got to scroll down. It doesn't have a number 1 listed on the quick list.
Well, what's number 5?
Listen, here's how it goes. 6, 18, 34, 46, 58, 63, 63.
Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show. 918-460-KMOD. You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Good morning, Lindsay.
Good morning, Corbin. And congratulations to Tracy Robinson of Chelsea, Oklahoma. She just got qualified to see them all in 2024. A chance to win a pair of tickets to every single KMOD concert for the rest of the year, including weekend VIP tickets to Rocklahoma. You can qualify too every single hour with us and throughout the day with Mel and J-Rod. From Yuengling, America's oldest brewery, and Tulsa's Rock Station, 97.5 KMOD. The first cue with Mel is right before Audio Slave at 11:12 this morning. And your next chance to qualify with us happens at 8 o'clock.
Good morning. Good morning, Gimpy. Well, good morning. The March Madness upsets have begun, and Bar Madness is in full effect. You don't want to be upset if you miss out on this one. It's a Sweet 16, a local bars battle, and win you some pretty awesome stuff. You can sign up to win said awesome stuff at the website that rocks, KMOD.com. That giveaway is coming up in a couple of weeks.
All right, we're giving away beer for Friggin' A Friday. What's something you've learned in the last week? A case of Keystone Light could be yours. So we'll go around the room here. Get yours to us, BMMS, and what that is to 82945. Every hour we give away beer on Friggin' A Friday. We just want you to answer this question today. What's something you've learned in the last week? Lindsay, what's something you've learned in the last week?
I have learned a lot of Greek this past week. My mother is here visiting from Indiana with her best friend, Denise. And Denise is the twins, Nuna, which is Greek for godmother. And she has been cooking Greek food and she has been speaking the Greek language. So I've been learning Greek phrases, but I learned how to make my absolute favorite Greek side dish, which is called tata mousselata. And it is a Greek dip that I have not had since I was in high school. And it is basically made with white fish raw, which is...
What's white fish raw?
It's basically, fish eggs.
Roe.
Yes, yeah. Roe.
Roe your fish.
And olive oil, onion pureed, and lemon. You don't taste the lemon, though.
Okay. Sure.
It just kind of kills the the fishy taste more so, dulls it down. And it's just made into a dip, and it is delicious, delicious. And you eat it with, you can eat it with pita bread, or I like it with French bread. Mm. Oh, it's so good. So delicious. So I learned how to make that. And
tell me some Greek you learned, some Greek words.
Okay. Malaka means dumb, or that was dumb. And you usually say it like, malaka. Like, that was stupid. Why would you do that?
Is that where the word malarkey comes from? Like, that's a bunch of malarkey?
Hey, malaka? Probably, since everything comes from the Greek phrase or Greek word. Or
are you reading off a cheat sheet?
No, but I do have, I have to write stuff down because you can't, I just can't memorize it. Mm. And I learned, well, Kevin learned because he wanted to know how to say beautiful lady.
Oh,
Amalfi Coppola.
Oh, try to say that again.
Amalfi Coppola.
Amalfi Coppola.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And Sagapo is I love you. And Kukla, which I've always known that, but my kids get a kick out of it because I've always called them Kukla, means baby doll. Yeah.
Okay.
So,
giving away beer Friggin' A Friday. What's something you've learned in the last week? A case of Keystone Light. Gimpy, what's something you've learned in the last week?
It ain't nothing sexy, I can tell you that. It's no foreign language or how to make foreign foods, but I learned my backing sucks.
Well, it's supposed to.
I understand that's what it's supposed to do. When I say suck, I mean it's... Listen, all right, so maybe like a month ago, I had to go out and buy a new vacuum because mine took a crap on me, right? Makes perfect sense. It happens sometimes. So I go and I do my shoppings at the Walmart, and I'm checking things out, and I'm like, all right, I want to do something different, something that I've never really done before. And I got a cordless.
Nice.
A cordless Shark vacuum.
Yes, they're the best.
Right? And this is a canister vacuum, stick vacuum. I keep it in my kitchen plugged in on the charger. When I need it, I just grab it and vacuum my house. And well, one, the canister, you would think it would hold more, but, you know, it fills up quickly, which isn't a big deal. Okay, fine. I vacuum the living room and then empty it out and then get the rest of the rooms and then empty it out again. But what makes it suck is that or lack thereof in this case. Yes. It gets clogged up easily. And I didn't realize that I'm vacuuming my house. And this is, I used it for the living room and I used it in the hallway and I used it in the weasel room. And the weasel room, I use an all natural litter for their litter box because they can't have like the clay stuff in case they eat it or whatever, which is disgusting, but they're animals. What are you going to do? It's bad for them. So I use an all natural corn husk litter. Okay. And much like cats, you know, they go in there and then they use the bathroom and then they kind of get the litter all over the place, you know. So I've got litter on the outside of the cage. When I clean their room, I've got to go in there and vacuum it up. And I would imagine that the vacuum would get it all up into the canister. But with this particular vacuum, it likes to build a barrier wall of dirt between, you know, the roller thing and the hole that sucks it, puts it back up in the canister. And I didn't think about that, to be honest with you. I empty it out and the canister's empty and I'm vacuuming my house like I normally would, and it's like leaving trails behind me and it's not sucking anything up. I vacuumed the entire house and the canister is still empty. I'm like, well, what the F is going on here? So I'm like, okay, well, now I got to figure this out, and I got to tear it apart. And it took a couple of rounds because I was like, I took everything apart, and I'm, you know, plunging the hole, you know, trying, you know, the stick, you know, trying to get that unclogged, and everything's clear in there, and it's clear in the hole that goes to the canister from the detached part. And I'm like, well, what the F is going on here? Why is my goddamn vacuum not working the way that it should? This is a bunch of hooey. What was it? Malarca. This is a bunch of malarca, okay? So I was like, I wonder, is it belt driven? I've never had a vacuum like this before. And all my experiences, vacuums mostly, if it's not sucking or doing its job, it's
a not belt. Getting enough attention.
Right. You didn't hug it enough that day,
right?
Son of a bitch.
You're not taking out the trash or breaking down Amazon boxes.
Right. It's usually like a broken belt. So I'm like, all right, where the hell? There's no belt involved in this thing. All right. So I pull it apart and that's when I see the northern wall of dirt. You know what I'm talking about? A little Game of Thrones reference there with the ice wall, but it's nothing but just dirt, dust, carpet fresh, and cat litter. And I was like, okay, I get it. So I grab my screwdriver and I clean all that out, put my damn vacuum all back together again, and we're back to sucking as we should.
Good.
As we should. But I didn't think that that would be an issue. I'm like, you do your job and, you know, suck things up. But it, whatever.
Did it come with attachments?
It came with one.
Okay.
One attachment. That like, that little extra stick thing that you get and you get into down into the corners.
Yeah.
Yeah, the real skinny one. But that's the only attachment that it came with, which I find disturbing. For one, there's no place to store it on said vacuum at all whatsoever.
I know.
So I got this stick part attachment and I got to keep it up in my closet somewhere. So anytime I want to get down in it, the closet and da da da. And there needs to be more attachments to this thing. I am seriously tired of putting my vacuum on the damn couch.
Big mad morning show.
I know, right?
I'm tired of having to vacuum my couch with the actual roller that I just rolled through the weasel room.
Mm-hmm.
It's not good at all. But you know what? It is what it is.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know vacuum, especially stick vacuums, require maintenance.
Yeah. I'm learning this the hard way.
I clean mine once a year.
Once a year, huh? Well, apparently
I don't get caught in that moment.
I got to clean mine out like once a month, apparently. Whatever is what it is.
If it's the same vacuum I'm thinking of, you can get more attachments for it.
He's not going to do that.
I know.
I might. You don't know that.
You are frugal AF. Yeah, you are not. You're like, why do I need to buy an attachment? I can just use the one that's on there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But like, again, I'm tired of lifting this thing up and putting it on the couch and going,
so heavy.
Nah, whatever. I feel like a weirdo vacuuming my couch anyway. But hey, it gets the dog hair off.
We want to know from you, what's something you learned in the last week? A case of Keystone Light. Get your answer to us. BMMS and what that is to 82945. The spectrum is wide on this topic. So I was reading a thing and was talking about Anne Frank. Anne Frank,
She was in Germany as a young child. Her parents moved her to Poland when Hitler became his thing. And we all learned about Anne Frank. She wrote a diary. She was caught. She was killed, right, at a young age. But became such a voice for so many people and just an impressive individual that, it, you know, if this is indeed the diary that was hers, that her dad took and then, you know, made into a book, mm-hmm. that's crazy, right? Because mm-hmm. she wrote that book never thinking anyone would ever read it.
Right, and now everybody.
And now everybody reads it, right? And then you have somebody like Martin Luther King, who obviously you shouldn't need me to explain to you the part he played in American history and the Birmingham bus protest that went on for over a year, many civil rights movements that he was a part of, right? The I Have a Dream speech, for those that don't know, was in a completely improvised speech. He had a speech written, didn't go with it, and went with that. I mean, the number of things that you can go down the rabbit hole about Martin Luther King and what he did to advance civil rights is insane. At one point, he was speaking at a church, and a man showed up and wanted to assault him, beat him up. Mm-hmm. And he was like, then hit me. And the man did and beat him bad in front of the whole church. And every time Martin Luther King got up and let him and tried to talk to him, and eventually the man stopped and they talked, right? Just insane amount of patience mm-hmm. that he displayed in multiple scenarios. Nonetheless, so the thing that I learned is that Martin Luther King and Anne Frank were born in the same year.
Oh, I don't know.
So then you, because I thought they were such different times, yeah. And they were, yeah. But I guess we don't know the Martin Luther King who was a child.
Right, right.
True. He was 13, right?
Yeah.
So I could go on and on about stupid, you know, it's not Greek or discovery in your home, but I learned yeah. George Washington had red hair.
Huh. It wasn't powdery white.
No.
Huh?
Thomas Jefferson, red hair.
Goddamn gingers have been running this country since the beginning.
Right, that's why things are all sideways.
Stealing our souls for that long.
Yeah. But he's like, oh, it's covered on Christianity. Not the devil.
Right.
Soulless. What's something you've learned in the last week? BMMS and what that is to 82945. Case Keystone Light could be yours if we pick your text, so get yours to us. BMMS space, what's something you've learned in the last week, to the phone number 82945. We'll take a break and we'll be back.
Tulsa's Morning Show. The Big Man Morning Show. The assault.
For that purpose, to go meet somebody. So either open this up to an open relationship, ask her, hey, do you want an open relationship? Or walk away now, brother, because you lost it.
Let me ask you, Scott, what would be an argument they would have had that would have not justified him cheating, but going out and being completely reckless? Like, what's something?
She would have had to cheat. I mean, the only way I'm ever going to cheat is she walks to me and says she just cheated. I'm walking out. I'm going to get me some, and I'm done with this relationship.
But then, you're not really cheating at that point, are you, Scott?
Mm-hmm. You know, until that divorce, I get it. But there's no hall pass or dinner or vacation. I agree with her vacation. That means she's not going to forget that. I don't care if 5 years down the road, that's going to be in every argument you have.
Mm-hmm.
So you might as well either walk away or open this thing up and let's become swingers.
Just walk up to her with a pineapple in hand.
Right on, man.
Upside down it, baby.
All right, Scott, have a great day, friend.
You too, guys.
All right, see you later.
Got a great idea to fix the situation.
I hear that, like, well, if she cheats, I'm going out right and cheating, you know, and cheating right away. It's going to be like the movie Hall Pass. I'm going to Applebee's and having wings and going to bed at 9. Like,
yeah,
right, because that's our routine now. No, that's where we're at.
No, I don't have the game. Like, what are you talking about? It's not like I'm turning down women every time I go out the door.
You go to the bar, you wait till about, you know, 1:45-ish.
Oh.
You know, you find the biggest woman with the least amount of teeth in her face, and you say, you're coming with me.
I gotta be honest, if I'm cheating as revenge, it ain't just gonna be on crumbs. Listener email, I'm about to get divorced from my wife of 10 years
Homeless
because
people eat out of garbage cans, Corbin.
I made a stupid mistake and had a one-night stand. We got in an argument. I left, went to the bar, and slept with some woman. Almost immediately, the guilt took over me. She's told me it's over, but I have to try. What can I do to get her or to give our marriage a second chance? Lindsay.
Okay, so he already did the most awful thing he could have done, and that was cheat. But he was honest. So he's got that going for him, at least. And if he wants to work things out, he's going to have to take the blame and take whatever is coming to him. If she is pissed, let her be pissed and just take it. Take the anger and just wait it out and see what she wants to do. The ball is absolutely 100% in her court. So whatever she wants, she gets at this point. If you want to stay in this marriage, if she wants to go through therapy, then you guys are going to go to counseling together. If she wants just you to go to counseling, then you're going to have to go to counseling. Because the ball is absolutely 100% in her court.
Gimpy.
Yeah, man, there's really nothing you can do, honestly. Just sit back and take your lumps as they are, all right? If she wants it to work, she'll figure it out. She's going to be mad AF for a long time, and you're going to have to deal with it. You're going to have to deal with being boring. There's not going to be any time going out with the boys or going out doing whatevs, you know? And if you can't handle that, then you need to walk away. You need to realize, well, I effed this one up. I'm just going to go ahead and take my ball, and I'm going to go home, and then I'll come back and play the game another day. You know what I'm saying? It's just there's nothing really you can do. Just let time pass it on by. That's it.
I'm sorry. I have no gimmick for you that will work. Mm. You tell her you want it to work. You made a giant mistake, and you're willing to work through it. She doesn't hear that. You got your answer. It's pretty black and white, man.
Yeah.
You have to eat your S sandwich. And when you go on and date in the future and be asked what happened with your marriage, you got to be honest. You S'd the bed royally. And so either you tell her what you want and hope she appeases you, but why beg someone to be with you? The Huffington Post has a list of the rudest things to avoid when you're visiting someone's home, like things you shouldn't do, right?
Oh, okay.
Touching or moving things.
Well, yeah.
Oh, so like I'm guilty of this though. Like if a picture
I'm shocked.
If a picture is crooked hanging on the wall, I'll straighten it.
Why?
No.
Why? It's not yours.
Exactly.
Nope.
Because I'm sure that it wasn't supposed to be crooked.
You don't know that. Some people like things off kilter like that.
Mm. I'll even mention it. I mean, fix that.
Oh, that's rude. That's like, you know, like the cliche of like a mom coming in, like, your pictures aren't straight.
Oh, Jesus Christ, Ma.
Another one. Expecting a tour.
Oh, yeah.
You don't walk in and be like, give me a tour.
No, I don't.
I totally do. I love snooping around.
Because I don't want someone to do that to me. Because what if your bedrooms aren't clean or the bathroom's not clean?
Then they'll let you know.
Yeah.
Furthermore, Susan, they shouldn't be having company over if that's the case. Bedroom, maybe. Right. Bathrooms, though. Clean that ass up if you're having company come over.
Another one. Overstaying your welcome.
Right.
How long? What's the good amount of time to stay at someone's house?
Depends on what the activity is.
Yeah.
Let's say dinner.
Oh, okay.
Couple hours.
2 hours after dinner. After 2 hours.
So you show up at 6, 8, get out.
Mm-hmm. Because now it's time for the family to wind down.
Yeah.
And start doing their own nightly routine.
And I think it depends on who it is, too. Like you always know, I think, depending on which friend it is.
Snooping.
Oof.
Yeah.
Going opening the cabinet.
Yeah, you
don't look through the medicine cabinet. You feel like you give the vibe that you do that.
No, I don't do that.
Okay, that's not an insult. I'm just saying it gives a vibe.
Why?
Because you're nosy. You're very nosy.
What makes me nosy?
Well, you'll walk into a room when a conversation's happening going, wait, what are we talking about?
Oh.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You love knowing other people's gossip?
Yeah. I'll watch those gossip shows.
No, I'm talking like personal gossip. I'm not talking about TV shows.
Yeah. If we're here, I don't want to miss out on anything for sure.
Yeah, that's nosy.
Yeah.
Bringing an uninvited plus one.
Yeah. Because now you're forcing the other people to like entertain somebody they don't know. It just makes
right,
everything.
Or don't yeah. like.
Exactly. And it's not your place to be inviting somebody else over.
Feeding their dog.
Huh? Oh, like table scraps or something?
I think that's what they mean,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I can't imagine you'd be like, where's your chow chow so I can put it in the bowl? Yeah. Some people do that. Some people think that because they feed their dogs table scraps or popcorn or whatever,
yeah,
that they can do that with your dog.
That's good that your dog's stomach is adapted to that. But now you're going to make your friend's dog crap all over their house because it's not used to that.
Showing up empty handed.
I don't think that's that bad. I mean, do I have to bring potato salad every time I come over?
No.
Exactly.
No, I always take something.
Yeah, I always take a bottle of wine.
Okay.
Always.
All right. I usually got my medicine on me, so that just works out perfectly.
Yeah, but that's not extra, right? Like you said, it's like offering him a cigarette.
Right. I don't have to share with you, though. That's the thing. I don't have to.
Yes, but you're not going out of your way is the point, right? Right.
Listen, I'm the guy that goes to Walmart and gets the cookies for the potluck that we're having here at work, okay? Do you expect more from me?
Yeah, I think if you go to someone's house and they're making, like, let's just say dinner still, mm-hmm. you got to take something.
Yeah.
I did. I brought
even
my
appetite. Even a dessert or wine, whatever.
Yeah.
Something.
It's just manners, Gimpy, right?
Right. Right. Yeah, sure.
No.
Listen, y'all invited me over. Okay, cool. I'll come over and have dinner. That's all right. Doesn't mean I have to bring a bottle of wine or a six pack or a bottle of anything for that fact. That's that. Unless you say so, hey, BYOB, bring a bottle, bring a side item. Yeah. We'll get the main course. That happens to me a lot. We got the main courses. Come on over to barbecue, whatever, bring a side item. All right, cool. Tater salad it is.
I've never gone to someone's house and like looked around and said to myself, that's so dirty here.
Oh.
Ugh.
Wow.
What, do they have lives? Right? I don't go, their sheets, they didn't even make their bed. I don't do all that.
Oh, I bet you have.
Look down my nose at you.
Because life happens.
Mm-hmm. Depends on the level of the filth. Right. If you walk into somebody's house,
if you're a hoarder,
looks like hoarders. Yeah, exactly.
I ain't going to your house. I already know you're a hoarder.
But this is the first time you didn't realize that they were disgusting people or hoarders until you walk into their house.
Oh,
right?
No. You can totally read a hoarder a mile away. No, you can read a hoarder a mile away.
Hoarder.
Yeah. You can read a hoarder a mile away.
You just tell by the way they dress. Their lack of showering.
Or by their vehicle.
For sure.
Yeah.
For sure. Right. I think absolutely. Mm-hmm.
But you still don't say anything. You just kind of watch where you sit down, maybe scooch the newspapers or whatever, paper plates with leftover pizza rolls on them and hang out for a little bit. And I got to go. I got it.
If I'm going to judge, I'm judging, like I'm going to judge the food.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not going to judge like, hey, your bed wasn't made.
Mm-hmm. No.
I'm going to judge, oh my God, you served Brussels sprouts or whatever that is.
Right.
I'm not going to get all like, ugh, you didn't clean for my arrival.
Right, right. You're right. Life happens.
Life
especially
happens.
If you've got small children. Oh,
and you're having a dinner party.
Right. You can expect toys to be all over the place. Now, there's a difference between, you know, a little clutter, kids don't know how to pick up their toys, and your house looks like Ross, Dress for Less. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah, I would think if you're hosting a dinner party, you would want to clean up.
You would think.
Yeah.
You would think.
But that's not necessarily true, especially if you're like, hey, come over tonight. We're having pizza.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Pizza feels like there's no cleaning happening.
Yeah, it's okay to have your laundry still piled up on the back of the couch from like 4 days.
No. You should at least pick it up and throw it on your bed.
Yeah.
Right. Right. Give me a place to sit.
Right. Just move the panties over. It'll be fine.
It's always like... I've gone and I stopped getting in the car with this person when I went to get in there. Show 918-460-KMOD. You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Let's play a game because we got tickets to give away. KMOD's Spring Fling Thing featuring Starset is April 13th at the Tulsa Theater. Tickets available at TulsaTheater.com. We're going to play the numbers game. Got to try and beat Lindsay. And you'll call up, decide what category you want, numbers, percentages, or averages. And then you'll get 5 questions from Gimpy. Lindsay will return in the room because she won't have heard the questions. And then she'll try to get closer to the answer than you. So 918-460-KMOD. Good morning. You're on the air. What is your name?
Hi, this is Jennifer.
Hi, Jennifer. How are you?
Doing good.
Good. What category do you want? Numbers, percentages, or averages?
Percentages.
Percentages it is. It's five questions from Gimpy. Just answer them the best that you can. Are you ready?
Okay. Yeah.
Here we go.
All right, Jennifer. In 2019, pies accounted for what percent of baked goods sales in U.S. grocery stores?
40%.
40%, she says. All right, Jennifer, according to Keebler, you know, the magical elves, what percent of Americans say they only eat pie 4 times a year? According to Keebler, what?
30%.
Okay. Hey, Jennifer, what? Jennifer, what percent of Americans say they never make a pie at home?
20%.
Okay. Jennifer, what percent of Americans say they prefer to make homemade pie on Thanksgiving? What percent of Americans say they prefer to make homemade pie?
80%.
Okay. Last one here, doll. Apple pie is the most popular pie in America by what percent?
50%.
50, overwhelmingly. What's your favorite pie there, Jennifer?
Pecan, actually.
Pecan?
Pecan! Yes.
Do you like it with the, have you ever had the Dixie one where they put chocolate chips in it?
No, I haven't tried that. It sounds good.
That does. All right, Lindsay, percentages is the category. You ready?
Ready.
Lindsay, in 2019, pies accounted for what percent of baked goods sales in U.S. grocery stores?
Let's say 40%.
Give me a different answer.
Okay. 41%.
All right, Lindsay. According to Keebler, you know the magical elves.
Yeah.
What percent of Americans say they only eat pie 4 times a year?
12%.
All right, Lindsay. What percent of Americans say they never make pie at home?
Never make pie at home?
Never, ever.
Never. 20%.
Give me a different answer.
Oh, 30%.
All righty then. Lindsay, what percent of Americans say they prefer to make a homemade pie on Thanksgiving?
Oh, 70%.
70%. All right, Lindsay, last one here. Apple pie is the most popular pie in America by what percent?
Ooh, 65%.
65%.
How do you think she did there, Jennifer?
We're pretty close on a lot of those.
No idea what you said. All right. So question one, Gimpy.
The question is, in 2019, pies accounted for what percent of baked goods sales in U.S. grocery stores? Jennifer said they accounted for 40% of sales. Lindsay said 40, but changed it to 41%. Price is right, editor. The answer?
Yes, she did.
The answer is 17%.
Yeah. Jennifer got that one right. Jennifer's up 1-0. You need 2 more to win those tickets to KMOD Spring Fling Thing featuring Star Set on April 13th at the Tulsa Theater. Question two.
Number two, according to Keebler, you know the magical elves. What percent of Americans say they only eat pie 4 times a year? Jennifer said 30% of Americans only eat pie 4 times a year. Why?
Lindsay's got a more realistic answer.
Lindsay said only 12% of Americans only eat pie 4 times a year. Then the answer is 63% of America eats pie 4 times a year.
I feel like that's a lot. I don't eat pie that often. Do you eat pie very often, Lindsay?
No.
I'm not even asking you. So Jennifer got that one right. She is up 2-0. You need 1 more for those tickets. Question three.
The question is, what percent of Americans say they never make a pie at home? Jennifer said 20% of them never make pie at home. Lindsay said 30%. And the answer is 40%.
Ooh, Lindsay got that one right. Mountain of comeback. She has 1. You have 2, Jennifer. Question 4.
The question is, what percent of Americans say they prefer to make homemade pie on Thanksgiving? Jennifer said 80%. The bulk of America likes to make a homemade pie on Thanksgiving. Lindsay said 70%. And the answer
is 69%.
Wow. Lindsay got that one right. It's tied 2-2. Comes down to the last question to see if you're going to get those tickets to see Star Set at KMOD's Spring Fling Thing on April 13th at the Tulsa Theater. Gimpy.
Well, the question is, apple pie is the most popular pie in America by what percent?
Preposterous.
Telling you. Well, Jennifer said 50%. It is the most popular pie by 50%. Lindsay said by far the most popular pie of all the pies, 65%. When the question was asked, apple pie is the most popular pie in America by what percent? The answer is 26%.
Jennifer got that one right. Congratulations, Jennifer. You got those tickets. Star Set will be here April 13th for KMOD's Spring Fling Thing. Hang on line so Gimpy can get your personal info, okay?
All right.
Congrats.
Good job. I am more of a cobbler guy. I'm not much of a pie guy.
Same.
You like shoes, huh?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. But if I had to pick a pie, probably coconut cream pie.
Yeah, I like a good cream pie. I'm a blueberry pie guy myself.
Yeah, fruit pies are good.
Yeah.
Yeah, what about you?
I like lemon meringue. Yeah. I know, or key lime. Yeah. I just like the meringue part. And I do like the flavor of coconut, but I don't like the texture of, like, the coconut slices that they put on top.
Shavings.
Mm. Yes. Can't stand that.
Okay.
Can't go wrong with a good banana cream pie.
That's true, too.
That is true.
Butterscotch pie.
Yeah, pecan pie, solid.
Yeah, and like, old school pumpkin, man.
But nothing tops for me like a blackberry pie or a blackberry cobbler with vanilla ice cream where it's still warm and it all gets gooey.
Mm. Yes.
So good. Sweetened condensed milk in my cobbler. Try it. I know.
Yeah.
Whatever.
No, it's a good hack. Mm-hmm. I was just laughing at what you said. You shared a lot about your vacuum and how to make a good cobbler, Gimpy.
Hey.
Yeah. Be on his Harley later. All right. We're giving away. He's off to a bake sale. Where do you put your pie when you're on your way to the bake sale? How did you get your shark vacuum home in your Harley?
Yeah, right.
We want to know what's something you learned in the last week, a case Keystone Light could be yours for Friggin' A Friday. BMMS and whatever that is to 82945.
The Big Mad Morning Show returns next.
I
wanted to see. All right, so let's just go with a couple things here because I'm trying to find fried mozzarella. I mean, that's just deep 10. Fried cheese. But even then, I want to give it like a 4.
Calamari.
10.
Calamari. I'll go ahead and give that like maybe a 6 or something because I've had calamari at other places that's not Italian food.
Bruschetta or bruschetta.
10.
Was that the fancy bread?
Most of the time it's toasted little pieces of bread with tomatoes and olive oil and balsamic and basil.
Yes, the extremely stale bread that you chip a tooth on every time you eat it. That's a 0.
Let's see. It's getting spaghetti and meatball ravioli.
Lindsay?
6.
Only if it's Chef Boyardee. Which actually his name was Chef Boyardee, but we had to Americanize.
Yeah. Give me your rating, Mr. Wikipedia.
1.
Tortellini.
4.
2.
Peppers and onions.
That's it? Like no sausage to put them on?
It's sausage, peppers, and onions. It's typically
a 4. Bun, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess with the sausage, peppers, and onions, I give it like a 3, 4, maybe even.
Fettuccine carbonara.
What's the carbonara part?
Bacon.
Oh.
That's a 5.
What?
1.
Eggplant parmigiana.
Yeah, that's 8.
That's a big 0 for me, homie.
Meatball sub.
Oh, God.
5.
This is getting worse and worse the further we go down. 0, man. That stuff is too messy. It doesn't eat well. You have to have a fork to eat a sandwich. I think that's retarded.
Oh, I liked it. Gnocchi.
What? Huh? Okay. I've had that come in like a HelloFresh or something like that once. And I was like, what is this? What is this garbage?
Oh, you didn't enjoy it?
Lindsay.
5.
0.
Whoa. Oh, my gosh.
I know it sounds crazy, but like when it comes to like the Big Ten of restaurants and foods and stuff, Italian's at the bottom of that list for me, man.
Somebody texted in and said, you think Zio's is delicious? You got to try Luigi's and Sky Took. So authentic. I think it's run by the actual Italian mob. I've had Luigi's and Sky Took. It's fine.
Mm-hmm.
It's fine. I like, it's not like I go to Zio's and I order one of everything.
Right.
Right. I worked there after college and their five cheese pasta, adding chicken to it, was so good.
Yeah.
Their spinach artichoke dip, which isn't Italian, whatever, but it was so good.
I just like the brown paper on the tables that give you crayons.
The cannoli. Yeah, I know how to write my name upside down. Cannoli, with the Alfredo and the chicken stuff, so good there.
I'll give you that. I'll give you the Italian dish, the cannoli. That's delicious just because it's cheese and powdered sugar.
No. That's the dessert.
I know.
Yeah, I'm talking about.
That's the only Italian food that I really, 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 really like is a good old cannoli.
We haven't gotten to the real one.
Uh-huh.
Pizza.
I've said it before and y'all thought I was crazy, you know.
1 to 10.
1 to 10. A pizza? That's going to be a 3 for me. So low on the scale, man.
Lindsay.
10. Always.
Pretty much all those except peppers and onions that we've mentioned are about anywhere between an 8 and a 10 for me.
Really?
See, I love peppers and onions. I don't love the heartburn, but man, it's almost worth the heartburn for me.
A good bolognese pasta?
Italian food. They are the Beatles for me.
Short rib braised ragu.
Ragu, the sauce in a jar.
So it's just, no. So good. I'm telling you, man, Italian food.
Man who killed Kevin Bacon charged with first degree murder.
You mean fifth degree?
Six degree?
Yeah.
So this happened in Michigan. A judge has decided that Mark Latunsky will face a charge of first degree murder after a degree hearing. The murder degree hearing for Mark Latunsky continued for a second day. This happened last Wednesday. He admitted to killing and mutilating Kevin Bacon, who is 25 years old. In court, he accepted a plea into open murder. The hearing was for the judge to determine if Mark will be sentenced for a charge of first degree or second degree murder, and the judge decided on the former. Back in 2019, Kevin Bacon, his body was found in Latunsky's home. He and Kevin Bacon met on a dating app, according to investigators. Kevin's body was hung upside down with a slit throat, according to police. Investigators also say that the man's testicles were removed and eaten.
This is a thing. How many stories have we read about castrations?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. At least a small handful that I can think of. I didn't even mean to do that.
I know you didn't. I can tell just by the way you delivered it. Yeah. It feels like it happened here in Oklahoma.
Yeah, yeah. Some guy come down to meet other two other guys, and they end up cutting his balls off or something like
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Is it for fun, or are they, you know, trying to prove a point? I don't get, because me personally, I would never chop my balls off for fun.
No. Is it a Moose a Muffin thing? Like you go for a little BDSM, just like tightening, and then there's some menacing people out there, like, I'm just going to slice them off.
Right. Let's see how far we can take this train. Okay.
That doesn't. I cannot piece together these stories. This is one of the stories we do that I'm like, I don't get it.
Right.
I don't get why it happens. I don't get the people that are up for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not that this was a willing participant. We don't know that part.
Right. The only thing that I can think of is obviously there's some kind of mental issue where the person whose balls are chopped off maybe has like a sex addiction or something to that effect. And they think that that's the only way they can get over it. The only way that they can cure themselves is to cut off that part of the body. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So therefore they won't have that sexual desire anymore, whether it's, you know, raping babies or
like just, dogs.
Yeah. That too.
The idea that you do dogs. So they don't want to hump.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think this is more of a Jeffrey Dahmer situation where they met on a dating app. The guy came over to the guy's house and he ended up tying this guy up.
Yeah, I'm not buying that, because then there would be more. Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show. 918-460-KMOD. Giving away beer, friggin' A Friday. All day, I should say all morning, we're giving away a case of Keystone Light.
what's something you've learned in the last week? BMMS and what that is to 82945. David is on the line. Good morning, David. How are you?
Hey, doing well. How's it going?
Good, man. David, what's something you've learned in the last week?
I learned to ride a motorcycle.
Tell me how you learned to ride a motorcycle.
Myers Duren Harley Davidson has a rider's class safety course and signed up for that. Went through, did the online course, in-person course, and then did 2 days on a bike with them.
Yeah. Hell yeah. It's a great program they do over there at Myers Duren. So question I have is, how old are you?
29.
And did you ever own like a bicycle or a scooter or anything like that?
I had a bike growing up, yeah.
Okay. So what was your biggest thing that you were like, I got to do this so I learn? Because you already understood the premise of balance.
So my biggest struggle was definitely the low-speed maneuvers. Like cornering at real low speeds.
Afraid that you're going to fall over?
Yeah. Just not getting the bike to do what you want it to do when you're going that slow.
And did you already own a bike or did you buy one after?
I just bought one this past week.
Congratulations.
What kind of bike is that?
I got a Classic 350 from Royal Enfield.
Okay. Right on,
Royal
man.
Royal Enfield, not bad.
Right on, man. Well, congratulations. Gibby, go ahead and tell him exactly what he's going to get.
Robin recently learned that he's about to be in the same class as the gonorrhea granny. You better watch for that drip, old timer. Here's a case of Keystone White. Back to you guys.
Hang on the line, friend. Gippy's got to get your personal info and have a fantastic weekend, all right?
All right, hey, thanks.
All right, man, be safe. Let's see what Gimpy has in his 4x4.
Well, Covenant says here that Harvard removed a human skin from book. Harvard's library says it removed human skin used to bind a book from the 1800s. The French book is part of the university's collection since 1934. It's a meditation of the soul and life after death. A doctor who used the skin of a dead patient to bind this particular copy left a note that said a book about the human soul deserved a human covering. Harvard verified the nature of the bindings a decade ago and says ethical considerations led to its removal.
I'm kind of against this.
Why?
History.
Makes sense.
It's not awesome.
Right, I get it. I say the same thing when they started tearing down statues. But
well, one that represents really negative connotation. Mm. I'm for that. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm not saying taking down a statue doesn't erase history.
Right. Neither does right? Removing the skin from a book.
No, but where people can't see it and learn that that was the thing is a different thing.
Right. Right.
You can still go read about how those people were leaders in that part of the war.
Right. Right. Hey, this is a fun story. 45 dead after bus plunges off a bridge in South Africa.
This is a crazy story.
Boy, I'm telling you. Authorities say that dozens are dead after a bus in South Africa plunged off a bridge yesterday. The bus was heading to an Easter festival in Limpopo, when the bus driver reportedly lost control. And according to the province's Department of Transportation and Community Safety, this is the fun part. The bus fell about 55 yards down before catching fire. Officials say 45 people were killed and only one passenger, an 8-year-old, survived.
Amazing. Amazing.
Now, is that kid destined for some stuff in life?
Like good stuff or bad stuff?
Maybe. I don't know, man. Dude. But he's a lone survivor, man. Yeah.
So many questions. Did their parents perish, right? Were they awake? Did they understand what was happening? Mm-hmm. Do they remember? Like, no, they're... I don't know what destined for great would be, but you're definitely going to carry some trauma baggage.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Still unbelievable.
At 8 years old, you remember things. At 8 years old.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And this is going to travel with him for a while.
Not a bad choice of words, but
you know what I mean. All right. Moving forward, the wealth of the 1% hits a record $44 trillion. The Federal Reserve reported that the top 1% reached a record $44 trillion in combined wealth at the end of last year. The most recent gains came from stock values increases, which netted over $2 trillion in the fourth quarter. The 1% own around half of individually held stocks. Since 2020, their wealth has increased by almost 15
trillion dollars. And then lastly here, 2024 Tulsa Heart Walk is taking place on 420. Thousands of people will meet at One Oak Field and walk through downtown Tulsa on April 20th as part of the 2024 Tulsa Heart Walk. You can register for the event as a team and raise money or show up on your own just to join in. Funds raised through the Tulsa Heart Walk will go towards research, CPR training, medical breakthroughs, and more. Champions for Equitable Health. Gates open at 9 and the walk begins at 10.
Several schools pulled off surprise upsets and advanced to the Elite Eight in the NCAA Men's College Basketball Tournament. The first number one seed of the tourney went down after fourth-seeded Alabama shocked North Carolina 89-87. Number six Clemson followed suit with a 77-72 takedown of second-seed Arizona. Meanwhile, number three Illinois edged second-seeded Iowa State 72-69. While top overall seed UConn took care of business against San Diego State 82-52. The Sweet 16 continues from Dallas and Detroit on Friday. Number one seeds Purdue and Houston are both in action.
They should be worried. I mean, NC going down is massive.
Yeah.
People, them and Houston were the ones that people thought were going to win it all.
Mm-hmm. Right. The Chiefs are officially adding an international rugby star to their roster. ESPN reports that Kansas City is signing European rugby player Luis Reese Zammit as a new offensive weapon. The expectation is for the Chiefs to look at Reese Zammit at running back and perhaps wide receiver. The 23-year-old participated in the NFL's International Pathway Pro Day last week after announcing in January that he was attempting to play in the NFL. This season will mark the first time that each team will have a 17th roster spot on the practice squad specifically available for an international player.
This is a huge deal because when you can, and I'm not saying he's going to be great, but to acquire a player that nobody knows anything about other than he's fast, how do you prepare for him?
Right.
You're going to watch his rugby film?
Yeah.
Right, because rugby play totally different than American different
football. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Probably super tough.
Sure. All football players are tough. But the idea that he's a pretty big guy and he runs a 4.2,
right?
That's
which is really fast. So I'm excited for that. It creates some excitement, like, ooh, what do we got here?
Mm-hmm.
But I think he's going to be a pretty versatile player. One of the great things about Travis Kelce is he's so versatile.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He can step behind the center if he needs to. He can run the ball. He's a great block. He's a pretty good blocker, right? He's a good downfield yards after catch.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can have a player that is so universal, dangerous.
Yeah, and this guy's young too, 23. So if he's good, he'll stick around. And that's your Balls to the Wall Sports. I'm Lindsay on 97.5 KMOD.
Balls to the Wall Sports is powered by Miller Lite, the original.
A corn on the cob vibrator.
Corn on the cob for the country girl.
It's gone.
It's got the
juice.
I'll
tell you all about it.
Yeah. That's exactly what I thought when I saw it.
Corn on the cob. I got to look.
Yeah. It makes sense if you think about the attachments that are with it.
Oh, God.
You know what I mean? Like the dimpling and bumps and all that other stuff.
Usually dimpling and bumps is not something you want to mess with, right?
Right.
You need to go see a doctor and get those bumps removed.
Some of you may have grandparents that have special china and some case in the dining room that's white with blue patterns on it.
Yeah.
The blue willow china?
Sure. This is a butt plug that looks like that.
Oh my goodness.
Honey, it's special anniversary night. Break out the fine china.
Yeah.
Another one, the penguin.
Uh-oh.
And it looks like a penguin whistling. And the part that would be the mouth of the penguin would apparently be where the magic happens for ladies.
The satisfier penguin. Oh, hey, look at that. A little bow tie and everything.
The Nerd Climax Dragon Finger.
What?
This is a sex toy that goes on your finger, and it is the shape or has the look of a like a dragon's claw. That's hey, so listen, weird. Lid for every pot, whatever you got.
What?
When we were in school, we had a thing. There were like these rubber balls with handles, and you would jump on them, right? And you would have races with them.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is that, except it is for the ladies.
That's so weird.
It's a Swiss ball dildo. This is Gimby has shown me the one he has before, which I ran. And this is the Accommodator.
The Accommodator.
If you know,
huh?
If you're familiar with that chin strap.
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you do. And then probably the mildest one on this list would be the Clone a Willy dildo kit.
Oh, yeah. I've seen those before.
Pretty mild.
Yeah. Thought about using it, you know.
I don't know how it would work.
What do you mean?
So have you ever seen like the in Hobby Lobby, they have those plaster Paris where you make the plaster Paris of like you holding your baby's
absolutely.
Hand or like you put your kid's foot in it.
Yeah, I did that in art class with my little hand. I know exactly what
fantastic.
You're talking about.
That would be this, except it comes in a tube. And the idea is you do what you have to do and then you do the mold and then it sets and then you. I don't one. Hair.
Yeah.
Two, any sort of deviation from what's happening in a sexual moment for me, it's over.
Right. Mm-hmm. So your dildo would come out all weird and deformed, pretty much, basically.
Or smaller than the representation.
Well, what am I going to do with this thing, huh?
And do you tell people it didn't work? Like, I couldn't do it?
That's why you read the reviews first, right?
And I don't know anybody that's done it. Mm-hmm. So I can't, I know they sell them.
Oh yeah.
So I'm sure someone's going to be like, oh yeah, it was great.
I'll get one over the weekend, put one together, bring it in for you Monday.
You don't have to bring it in. You can just give me the verbal review.
Ohio man who refused to share bag of chips with stranger shot in the face. Melvin Wright, 42 years old, was arrested on Wednesday for allegedly shooting a 31-year-old man in the face on Tuesday night outside Lusty Adventures, an adult entertainment club, for some potato chips. He asked for potato chips, but he refused, according to the Akron Beacon Journal. The victim told police that Wright then allegedly pulled out a large handgun, shot him before escaping in a vehicle. The 42-year-old was arrested after he was seen boarding a bus at the Metro Transit on South Broadway Street, according to the Akron Beacon Journal. He was carrying a handgun when he was arrested, the one that might have been used in the shooting. The police department said the victim is currently being hospitalized, and he went into the emergency room on his own. Wright was charged with felonious assault and weapons under disability and is currently being held at the county jail.
I mean, that's one of those, like, the headline, he was shot in the face. Can you guys log in? You wouldn't be able to, like, move.
Right.
So it must be, like, a glancing.
Like, grazed his
face. Grazed his face.
Something like that.
Okay.
And when you look, I'm looking up this place.
Yeah.
I wouldn't go in there. Just by the outside of it looks like, one, they're still in business. It looks pretty run down based off the outside of the place.
Yeah. Oh, God. I hope that's not one of the answers.
That there's no way there's not drugs running through this place.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. Oh, God.
Yeah, I'm not surprised somebody got shot in the face outside of this place, to be honest with you. It looks like it carries that type of clientele.
Oh, man.
These girls are sad.
That's her nipple. Yeah. That's her nipple right there on Facebook.
Yeah, there's definitely meth running through this place.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, God.
And just plain potato chips?
Yeah.
Just plain potato chips, huh?
I mean,
some Lay's maybe, some of those kettle chips. I got it.
The kettle chips are the best.
Have you had the the High Point Bay or whatever, the one with the lighthouse. Uh-huh. And they have waffle ones that are so good.
Okay.
Yeah. Waffle potato chips.
Okay.
So good. Their wavies are solid too.
Okay. Not much of a tater chip fan, to be honest with you.
Or Ruffles, really. I like, no.
Ruffles are too much ridges for me.
Yeah.
I'm more of a wavy guy.
That's how you hold all that dip in there, though, man.
Yeah. I know it sounds, because the Ruffles are too dense.
Mm-hmm.
There's too much byproduct there.
Mm-hmm. Too much tater in my chip.
But kettle chips, oof.
Yeah.
Salt and pepper. That. Oh, my
okay.
gosh.
Okay.
Oh, my gosh.
Florida man arrested after whipping out his willy in an Uber. This happened on January 27th, Saturday night, around 8:45. Jason Haggerty, 46 years old, was in Tampa, and his Uber driver drove him to St. Petersburg. While en route, Jason displayed and exposed his willy and proceeded to masturbate the duration of the ride until arriving home. The driver told police he speaks no English and was unable to tell the defendant to stop. Though he did use his phone to record the defendant masturbating. The driver said that Haggerty ejaculated inside the vehicle.
Oh,
wow.
Yes.
Wow. Got an extra cleaning fee for that one, right?
Yeah.
I think there's just the standard, right? I don't know. Isn't there? You're the only person that's ever drove rideshare, so there's a standard cleaning fee, right?
I guess. I mean, yeah, if somebody barfs in your car, I think it's like an extra $300, but there's a little difference between vomit and... semen.
He did say that he had to personally clean up the fluid from his vehicle. An arrest affidavit noted that there was a third unknown person in the vehicle's back seat who spoke up for the victim.
So she said,
at the conclusion of the ride, police believe alcohol played a role in the incident. Haggerty is a licensed nurse practitioner. He was arrested for exposure of sexual organs, a misdemeanor, and booked into the county jail. During a court hearing, which happened this past Friday, the 2nd, a judge ordered Haggerty released from custody after posting his own bail. He puts the ew in Uber. He drove him to his $655,000 townhouse that evening.
I don't know why that's in there.
Yeah, I don't know either.
Because people with money should know better than to masturbate vigorously in the back of an Uber.
People in the front. He was in the front seat.
People.
Oh God.
I
didn't hear that part of the story.
I thought it was in the back seat.
Next to the driver.
Why didn't the driver just stop the car?
Why didn't he punch him in the balls?
No kidding.
And when you are an Uber driver, maybe some of the Uber drivers can answer this, unless Gimpy went through this. Mm. If you have to charge a cleaning fee, do you 100% get all that money? Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show, 918-460-KMOD. You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Good morning, Lindsay.
Good morning, Corbin. Hey, we got Willy Nilly coming up in the 9 o'clock hour this morning. You got something you want to talk about? Use the talk back feature and let us know what that something is on the iHeartRadio app. It's simple to use. Just let us know what you want to talk about and use that button. Hit it. Let us know what you want to talk about. Use the talk back feature.
Good morning, Gimby.
Well, good morning, Corbin. Smoking Guns 9 is coming up April 27th at the BOK Center. This is where cops and firefighters beat the holy hell out of each other for charity. For the Oklahoma Firefighters Burn Camp and the Special Olympics of Oklahoma, you can get your tickets at BOKCenter.com.
Congratulations to David Baldwin of Broken Arrow. David got qualified for CML 2024, a chance to see every concert KMOD is a part of, including VIP Weekend Rocklahoma tickets. Every hour with us, you have a chance to get qualified. So make sure you're listening. Another chance coming up in 54 minutes. It's all from Yuengling, America's oldest brewery in Tulsa's Rock Station, 97.5 KMOD. A little taser time trivia. Who was the last person to go last week?
That would be me.
All right. So Gimby's going to pick the first person that's going to go. We've got questions and envelopes, and you have to answer three questions to avoid getting shocked. You better get them right.
Mm-hmm.
First person going.
That is going to be Corbin.
All right. So going to hand the taser over.
I'll take that. You get the questions. Is that a deviled egg or just a hard-boiled egg?
It's a hard-boiled.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, bro.
Why?
Because she's in here eating hard-boiled
eggs. Better than her vape.
I guess that is true. I'd rather smell your stinky egg farts.
I eat them too.
You guys are both eating eggs. Well, yeah. Where's my hard-boiled egg?
One? Wait, just a minute ago, you dogged on it.
I didn't dog on it. No.
Your tone of voice didn't make it sound awesome.
I wasn't expecting to see her eat a hard-boiled egg this early in the morning, and I don't think I've ever seen her eat a hard-boiled egg ever before.
Oh yeah. Now, so. Oh yeah. Delicious. I'd rather eat that than those stupid little souffle things she eats.
Uh huh.
Yeah, I felt it.
Okay, just making sure it's still working.
Listen, I have a good keen of ability to know what's happening to you by looking at your eyes, so I knew what was happening.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I knew you weren't going to shock me.
No.
All right, so Lindsay's got these questions that have been made by somebody outside the room, and Gimpy's holding the electrifying agent. So she's going to ask the questions, and hopefully she won't knock over her hard-boiled eggs while we do this. All right, Lindsay, question one.
Question one, what bird's eye is larger than its brain?
Huh? What bird's eye? Is this a trick question? What bird's eye is bigger than its brain?
That is the question.
What bird's eye is bigger than its brain? So like... I got to be honest, I don't know the size of a lot of bird brains. Yeah. I feel like I want to, this has to be an easy answer. It can't be like, you know, the African, right? It can't
That's be my some, favorite bird.
It can't
man.
Be yeah. some rare bird no one's thought of.
Right, right.
It's got to be a pretty, if I remember from my Where There's a Will, There's an A course, it's got to be a pretty obvious answer if the question's so in depth like that.
Uh-huh.
So I'm going to say, I want to say an owl, but because they have huge eyes.
That would make sense, logically speaking. I don't know the answer to this, and I feel like I know some things, but yeah. I don't. I'm out on this.
Okay, I'm going with Al.
Who?
Not the guy who owned the diner on Happy Days.
What about Tim
or Bundy? Al is my final answer.
All right, you say owl, and the correct answer is an ostrich.
Ostrich, huh?
Okay, that would make sense.
They got tiny heads.
Very tiny.
Yeah, and big old eyes.
Big eyes.
Yeah, okay.
Tiny brain.
Big eyes.
Big eyes. Okay, I guess I know they are a bird, but I guess I don't think of them as a bird because they're so massive.
Yeah, they don't really fly. They more flutter than anything.
Flutter.
Like chickens.
Again, I knew it was going to be an obvious answer, and ostrich should be an obvious answer. Okay. I mean, they make good legs at the fair.
Right.
Yeah. Question two.
Which U.S. president... is honored in the Wrestling Hall of Fame?
Abraham Lincoln.
Ah, you came in quick
really
with that
quickly.
One.
Yes. Very confident. How confident are
I
you?
I mean, I was when I said it.
Yeah.
And now that I'm marinating in it, I feel like that's I can't, it's not.
Yeah.
I mean, but I'm going to stick with it. I know he was a wrestler. I'm sure that it could even be someone like Eisenhower.
Roosevelt. Teddy Roosevelt, because he was a badass.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I mean, anything's possible. Like, Eisenhower was a president who his kid died, and his wife and his kid died or something, and he left his kid alone and went to, like, the Dakotas.
I'm out of here, bitches.
For, like, nine months or something. I'm going to stay with Lincoln. It was my gut answer. Yeah, Lincoln is my final answer.
Yeah, you always say go with the gut, or I always say go with the gut, and you say Honest Abe Lincoln, final answer, it is correct.
Hooray!
Nicely done.
Congratulations.
Question number three. What was the first car launched into space?
I want to say a Tesla. Because we just saw that one.
Mm-hmm. But they used to put a lot of weird stuff in space when we first started going to space.
I don't think they put cars, though.
Right? Monkeys and dogs.
Right. By the way, that thing's still... Did it fall down, or is that Tesla still floating around up there?
Still floating around.
An amazing display of, like, negligence.
Right?
Yeah, well, just... That's a car. Just whatever. Fine. Whatever.
Just throw it into space. Aliens are like, hey, I got a new Tesla. Hey.
Right. The lack of, like, you have so much money. You're like, yeah.
Why not?
Yeah, I feel like Tesla is a good answer. I feel like it. And how far is space?
True, true. Inner space, outer space.
We have some billionaires who say they've been to space, but they really haven't. They were on the edge of space, right? I'm going to go with Tesla. That feels like the safe answer. Tesla, my final answer.
The first car launched into space was a Tesla Roadster.
All right.
Congrats. God.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think they put any other cars like a 67 Buick in space or anything, but you never know.
I feel like it would be pretty negligent of NASA.
Mm-hmm.
But the ones I didn't think about was like China.
Right.
Or Russia. Right. So I feel like that was where I was worried.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
I get it.
Next person going. Lindsay.
All right.
Will she keep her undefeated record of not getting shocked? This would be the week three.
Yeah.
If she
four.
Four.
Almost a month if she doesn't, or it would be a month if she gets by on this.
Yeah. So she's putting the electrical device around her body there, and we'll see when she's ready. And then we've got three questions. Gimby's getting those ready. They're made by somebody outside the room, so we don't know what they are. Only the person reading them knows what they are at the time.
I'm ready. Okay. Yeah, I feel that.
All right, just making sure.
Okay.
Lindsay, question one.
Number one.
Vibration sensation.
What was the first animated series to air on primetime TV? What was the first animated series to air on primetime TV or television?
Primetime television would be more like late night, I'm assuming.
Yeah. Even
not a like a cartoon as far as like Saturday morning cartoons.
Prime what was time. The first animated series to air on primetime TV?
Your Family Guys. You've got The Simpsons. You've got Bob's Burgers was later on. That was like just a couple of years ago. And then there's, what's the other one?
What was the first animated series to air on primetime television?
But you know what? Going back to cartoons. No. Okay. There were cartoons on at night.
What was the first animated series to air on primetime TV?
A lot riding on the line here.
Tom and Jerry was on at night, I think, and Flintstones were on at night, I believe. Flintstones didn't start in the mornings. I think Flintstones.
Flintstones, final answer?
Yeah.
The first animated series to air on primetime TV was The Flintstones.
Wow.
Right.
I got to be honest. I would have said Simpsons.
Right. As would I.
Yeah.
Back in the late 80s, 88, 89, something like that.
Awesome.
Thank you. Yes. So my dad used to watch that as a kid and as an adult. Thanks, Dad, because he schooled me on television as a kid. Like I would watch Flintstones on Saturday mornings.
He watched it at
night.
I got to be honest. I'm just impressed that you knew that and could remember that, because you could remember Greek that you learned just this week. So,
well, I have to write it down because they're
sure. Whatever. It doesn't matter. All right. So question two.
Question number two, Lindsay, what is the most common surname in the U.S.? What is the most common surname in the U.S.?
Common surname.
What I love is that she's got this undefeated record, and we don't know what the questions are.
No.
But these aren't easy. I don't think these are easy home runs.
That's the first one wasn't. That's for damn sure. What is the most common surname in the U.S.?
Probably Mr. I'm going to say Mr.
Mr. is your final answer?
Yes.
Lindsay, the most common surname in the U.S. is Smith.
Oh, shoot.
surname being last name.
Salutation.
Okay. I would think it was last name.
That's why that question's difficult, because we were all like, surname? I didn't know the answer.
Wouldn't you have said last name?
No, that would be surname.
Okay, I'm thinking of Okay, never mind. Okay.
But nonetheless, her streak is now over.
Wow.
It's
been a while.
Yeah.
Forgot, huh?
Damn, yeah.
Yeah.
Feel it right on a nerve or a vein.
Yeah, feel it right on the spider hole, huh?
Damn, man. Yeah.
Ow. All right, question three.
I still feel that one.
Lindsay, last one here.
Yes.
Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park. Lindsay, adult tickets cost $51 each. A child ticket costs half as much. What is the total of the tickets? I'll say it again. Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park.
Two adults.
Adult tickets are $51 each, and child tickets cost half as much. What is the total cost of the tickets?
Okay. And two child, right?
Two adults. Child. Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park. Adult tickets cost $51 each. Child tickets cost half as much. What is the total of the tickets?
She's doing math on a piece of paper. Go ahead and audibilize some of that work.
She can't think and talk at the same time.
You know Jordan. I can't.
Yes, she can. I hear her do it every day for like 4 hours.
Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park. Adult tickets cost $51 each. Child's tickets cost half as much. What was the total of the tickets? That's the question.
So, 50. Okay. Hundred.
Instead of talking, we just hum now.
You are overcomplicating this question,
right? Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park. Adult tickets cost $51 each, and child tickets cost half as much. What was the total of the tickets?
$102 for the adult tickets.
Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park.
She's getting a second piece of paper, folks.
I'm writing all over the place.
Adult tickets cost $51 each. The child tickets cost half as much. What was the total of the tickets?
And half of that, it would be $153.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah.
Hold on, let me get ready.
Okay. Lindsay, Gracie buys two adult tickets and two child tickets for the water park. Adult tickets cost $51 each. Child tickets cost half as much. The total for all of the tickets that Gracie paid for is $153.
Yeah. Jesus. It's 51 times
Thank
three.
You. Yes. Jesus. Yes.
That was awesome. Good. Yeah. She was like,
I know.
She was getting her own way so much.
I do.
You're fighting to swim there. I was like, good God, girl.
I was.
Don't fight the water.
Math makes me so nervous and anxious.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you got shocked once. I've been shocked once. Will Gimpy also get shocked once? We'll find out when we come back. While we're doing that, why don't you guys send a text? Tell us what's something you've learned in the last week. A case Keystone Light could be yours. BMMS and what that is to 82945.
On the floor, whatever. So when that happened, there was an audible pop that led me to believe that, like, oh yeah, this is definitely what, like I said, wasn't broken or anything, because there is no bone to break. It's just it hurt. It hurt. And it was out of commission for a couple weeks. And I sighed.
Sure.
But you're right. I didn't go to the doctor and be like, doctor, I think I broke my Peter.
Yeah, there's plenty of people that break bones and don't know they've broken a bone.
Right.
There are players, football players, that run on broken legs.
Mm-hmm.
And don't know that they're broken until later.
Okay, so to me, broken and fractured are two totally different things. Like a hairline fracture, a small fracture, you can still perform with a fracture. But like when I broke my leg, it was broke, floppy doppy.
Yeah.
There's no way I could stand on it. You know,
penile fracture is this term.
Yeah.
But people say the same thing.
Yeah, say
fracture
it's
broken. And broken, mm-hmm. kind of. Unless you're a medical doctor using it looks like you have a fracture or you have a broken arm.
Right. So with that,
because Dr. Stuck Serious, that's why this voice works.
So when it comes to the penile fracture, you know, I just said, you know, most people can work through a fracture, a hairline fracture. There is no working through that one. that's just too sensitive of an area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, how does it get fixed? You just ice it?
Just time.
Yeah. Like a lot of breaks. Yeah. Like if you broke your foot, you just don't do it. You just have to be careful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you still have to walk on it.
The cast. Yeah.
Right.
Not something I'm signing up for.
Right.
And having it removed. Pass. Hard pass.
Right. Where they break out.
Soft pass.
Yeah. It won't cut you. Mm-hmm. Not taking a chance there, Doc. Teen arrested for setting hotel fire after fighting with mom. This also comes out of Florida. Ocala, Florida, where I guess a 16-year-old girl got in a fight with her mom at like 3:30 in the morning. And then goes down into the lobby and sets a sofa on fire. So the police and the ambulance and the fire trucks, everybody comes out, all these emergency crews or whatever. All 320 residents of the hotel, all the guests were evacuated at 3:30 in the morning. So the firefighters came in and they're battling through the smoke-filled lobby and they find the fire. Source of it, the couch is on fire. They put it out with their little water can. They say that the damages cost a couple of $100,000 to this couch and the wall that was behind it, totally scorched, burnt up. Pictures are on our Facebook page. They ended up arresting the girl. They didn't say what the girl and the mom were fighting for over, and they didn't say what led to, you know, her wanting to set the couch on fire. My guess is probably just angry teen and probably had some alcohol involved in there somewhere. That's just my theories on it. Nonetheless, they went ahead and arrested her for arson and the investigation continues.
So many things on this.
Mm-hmm.
That dude, they don't let you get your luggage. Like you went out of the hotel and then they're like, you can't go back in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you got to go find a place without your stuff.
Right.
Wallet, probably.
Right.
Credit cards, probably.
Maybe your phone.
And so all you're in is your skirt, you know, your tidy whities or whatever.
So you're talking about 320 guests that were evacuated. They did let them all go back in. All the guests were allowed to go back into their room and go back to sleep after it was all said and done.
I'm shocked by that because the sprinkler system has gone off.
But just
and it flooded the floor.
The lobby area, though. Just the first floor and that lobby area. Anybody
still feels like danger, Will Robinson.
Nine. Oh, I totally get you. Smoke damage, smoke inhalation, whatever. I was surprised that they let them all go back in as well, but that's what they said.
Dude, I was unaware that sprinkler systems in a building go off by floor.
Yeah, I thought it was all automatic all at one time. Everywhere.
Yeah. Maybe this is a different one, but the story did say that they let all 320 guests or everybody that was evacuated go back to their room later on that morning, probably about 5:30 or so. Still, 3:30 in the morning, you woke up, you're probably on vacation.
Sure.
You gotta evacuate everybody, go meet in the parking lot over there by the fourth
Bob Evans
street light. Yeah. Right, exactly. And then you're waiting there for hours. Yeah, after they get everything cleaned up, you know.
Smoke fills the whole place.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, and they're like, you can go back. I'd probably be like, okay, I'm going to go get my stuff and I'm going to check out and go find another place. And then we'll deal with reimbursement after this.
All right. Then the other thing I was thinking about, your kid does this. What do you do?
What's the punishment?
Right, right. We'll deal with this when we get home.
How old was the girl?
16.
Yeah. Like, what do you do?
You're grounded. Grounded.
No screens.
Yeah. Right, right. She's 16 and went to jail for arson. So chances are this parent or the parents are going to be like, well, she went to jail and she's being charged. And they're probably going to take out the couple $100,000 worth of damage out of her
allowance.
That's
a whole. Yeah, right?
Right.
It feels too late. Like, right. She's
so give up. Okay. Give up on your kid. Okay.
No. I'm not saying that.
You're a lost cause.
That's what you said. It's too late.
Why don't you go live on the streets with the rest of the crackheads?
No, but I mean, like, it's too late to be like, you're grounded for, you know what I mean? Like,
well, typically punishments come after the infraction.
Sure, but she's in jail.
It'd be weird to ground your kid like you're a precog or something for something that hasn't happened yet.
She's in jail.
I don't know what you did yet.
but you're grounded. I know you're going to do something. Grounded.
I hope jail kind of wakes her up a bit.
Well, she's not going to jail.
She did. They arrested her.
But she went to juvie.
Right. Okay. And she probably may not spend a whole lot of time
which is an education system.
Right.
I mean, there's probably going to be big time fine. She's going to have to go to court.
Her parents will pay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She will not be paying. That's what I'm saying. Like, she is going to be released probably to their.
Yeah. She'll be paying
supervision.
Back.
Mm-hmm.
She's my kid.
No, she won't be paying back.
If she's my kid, she is.
No.
She's going to be working it off. Hard labor.
For 40 years?
Busting rocks in the backyard.
This isn't you bought her an iPhone.
Right.
Ka-chink.
This is, as Gimpy said, if not two commas, it is definitely 100,000.
Mm-hmm.
She would be paying back forever. Mm-hmm.
You owe me every paycheck for the rest of your life.
Well, that makes no sense either.
When you retire, I want your retirement. I want your 401k. Yeah.
See what I'm saying? Like, it just creates all these questions.
There's only two ways that you can pass a whiz quiz without using some kind of illegal substance. And that is one.
Broccoli?
No.
Oh.
just naturally stopping. Okay. And cleaning yourself out.
Surefire. Yeah.
Absolutely. That's like, you know, abstinence is the only way to guarantee not getting pregnant. Nonetheless, The other way, which is only good for like an hour or two, maybe a day, is a flush. And that's just to drink a buttload of water, because when you do that, you're not urinating anything for your test, but just straight water.
Well, that's why when you buy those pee cleans, they're like, drink a ton of water, because it isn't that. It's it's the flushing. Have you ever taken a marijuana drug test,
yeah.
Lindsay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In a past.
Okay, what's the story? Like,
just for a background check for a job. But I don't.
In radio?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Yeah. The first radio station I ever worked at in South Dakota.
Huh.
Yeah. But at the time, I was 20 years old. So I wasn't really into pot so much. So it wasn't a big deal.
I didn't do the marijuana at the time.
And also, I had to take one when I started substitute teaching. So back in Indiana, I had to take one. And again, I wasn't even back then a heavy pot smoker. So it wasn't enough, like, in my system to even worry.
Are you a heavy
pot
smoker now?
No, I'm not.
Well, at least you were implying that you weren't, so I didn't know if you were.
So I've never had to worry about it. Yeah, it's never been in my system enough to even worry about it.
Besides, Gimpy, you said one. How many have you taken total in your whole?
One to get a job at Target.
Huh?
No, excuse me. I just lied to you. Sorry. The other job, two, as a matter of fact, one to get a job at Target. And the other one was to get a job when I was selling parts, the job that I had before I got here. And I had failed that one. I had tried. I was like, all right.
I love that you put some sympathy tone on it. Like, I tried.
I did. I quit for a couple of weeks. And I'm like, all right, that should be good enough. Right. I'm not. THC absorbs in your fat cells. I'm not a heavy guy, so therefore I thought it would flush it out a lot, you know, sooner. It wouldn't stick around in my body as long as it did. So a couple of weeks go by, I'm like, all right, bet I'm good. And I go down there and I take their whiz quiz, and it comes back. You tested positive for the marijuana. And
you hadn't smoked in how long?
It'd been a couple of weeks. I completely stopped.
It can hang. Hold on. Mm-hmm. I thought that was like recent. I didn't think whiz was weeks.
No, it's the THC absorbs in your fat cells. So it stays in there for a while. And if you're a bigger, heavier dude and a heavy smoker, and that's another thing you got to think of. Heavy smoker I was. So therefore I thought, okay, a couple of weeks, I'm not a fat guy, I should be good, not taking into account the amount that I put into my body on a daily basis. Okay. So I failed that one, and they're like, all right, we'll give you another shot, but you got to wait for 6 months. You got
to get the job,
to take another whiz quiz. So I was like, all right, fine.
6 months hardly makes sense.
That's what they told me. And I was like, bro, I really wanted this job. You know,
so did you start the job and then in 6 months they tested you?
No, I couldn't get the job until they tested me and I tested positive. So for 6 months I go straight. I quit
completely for those 6 months.
Impressive.
And I know.
Very much so.
And so I took my test. I passed it with flying colors. And then I started back up again. And I tell you what, it has not been the same since. The very first time I got roasted after not doing it for 6 months, I was like, it messed with my mind so much. I was like, this is not what I remember it being. Oh, it's because my tolerance dropped. Mm-hmm. I was like, well, I guess we're just going to have to build it back up. But you're talking, you know, from 16 to 25. So 9 years of just steady smoking all day, every day. My tolerance was way up there. So I was like, yeah, I guess we'll have to start all over again.
Challenge accepted.
Yep.
I worked at The Edge, and the company that owned them in another market. Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show.
918-460-KMOD. You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Try and do it over again.
All right. So we are in the middle of Taser Time Trivia. And the way this works is that you have
And then when I come back, they call me into the office like right away.
The button is pushed, and Lindsay is holding the button, and Gimpy has now armed.
I am officially strapped in and ready to rock.
He's got a strap on, and he is ready to get shocked should he get questions wrong. We have not seen these questions. I haven't even looked. I just opened it. Are you ready for question one?
Oh, yeah, let's have it.
Yeah, just go ahead and try it one time and leave it running. Okay. Question one. How many ghosts chase Pac-Man at the start of the game? Turn it back on. Turn it back on.
How many ghosts at the start of the game?
How many ghosts chase Pac-Man at the start of the game?
Just pulling a number out of my ass, three.
Three.
I think it's three.
Have you played Pac-Man? When was the last time you played Pac-Man?
Oh, dude, it's been decades since I've gotten down on some Pac-Man. So I'm just trying to go back in my mind when I was a small child and remember seeing. And now here's the trick question. Is it the beginning of the game, like after you press start and you start playing the game? Or is it when, you know, the theme comes on and they're chasing him around? I have no idea. That's why I just reach deep in there and I pull that number out. And three is the number that's screaming in my head. I could be wrong, but, you know, whatever is. What it is, what it is.
Final answer is? Final answer is?
Three.
Three. How many ghosts chase Pac-Man at the start of the game? Gimpy said three. The answer is four.
Ah, son of a bad bitch. Mother. Wow. Woo. That one hurt. That was my second guess.
Yeah.
And didn't the ghosts have names?
It was like Inkin, Blinkin, and Dot, and Inkin, Blinkin, Stinkin, and Dot, or something like that. Hell, I don't know.
Yeah. Go ahead now, do it, please.
Okay.
Question two. In what country is the Chernobyl nuclear plant located? In what country is the Chernobyl plant located?
Man. I want to say Russia. I know it's over there.
Over there, finally.
But it's probably some other odd-ass name that I don't know. You know what I mean? Like, I almost cussed right there. I had to bite my tongue on that one because I'm about to say F it. F it. We're going to go with Russia. Whatever. Probably like Ustin or some jive, whatever. I'm still sticking with Russia, but yeah, final answer.
In what country is the Chernobyl bomb plant located? You said Russia. The answer is Ukraine.
Hit the goddamn button, woman!
I did!
But that counts.
If the screen was dark.
That counts.
Then she hit the button and lit it back
it
up.
It was blue. Okay.
Can I see it, please? Try it again.
Ah, bitch!
Okay, there it works.
God damn it.
Okay, question three. Will Gimpy go 3 for 3 on the shocks today?
F, might as well.
Spell.
Kiss my ass.
Kiss my ass.
Entrepreneur. Spell. Why'd you yes?
It's a good word.
Spell entrepreneur.
E.
Good start.
T. Preneur. Trepen. U E R.
God, I'm glad you got this one. I love that that's a random envelope grab. We have no idea what's in each one. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would have suffered on this one.
Is it an E or is it an A? That's the question. Entrepreneur. E. Are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
All right. Starting with the letter E.
Okay.
And then an N.
Yes.
And then a T.
Okay.
And then an R.
Okay.
And then an E.
Okay.
And then a P.
Okay.
And then an A.
Okay.
And then an N.
Okay.
And then a U.
Okay.
And then an E. And then an R. Entrepreneur.
Make sure I've got this right because I don't want to get it wrong. Entrepreneur.
That is correct.
Spell entrepreneur. You said entrepreneur, which is incorrect.
Go ahead and zap me, goddammit.
Ah, bitch. All right, stop.
The correct spelling is Entrepreneur.
Oh, good for you.
That is not a friendly word to spell.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. God.
I, too, would have gotten it wrong. America.
A lot of
three
vowels.
Three times in the same spot is not good for the leg, man.
Yeah.
Has anybody ever been zapped three in a row before?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, just making sure.
Oh, yeah. I feel like I definitely have.
The electricity that's passed through me over the past month or so has kind of fried some cells.
You're
so
definitely more awake, I can tell.
Yeah, you are.
All right, we're giving away beer. What's something you've learned in the last week? A case of Keystone Light, BMMS, and what that is to 82945. We'll be back.
You're listening to the Big Mad Morning Show.
This is...
I've never...
Horrible tip.
That's technically a tip. I've never... No.
Yeah. Now, if you were at a... Did you ever DJ a gentleman's club?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. I mean, I'm not saying that I wouldn't or wouldn't have back then, but no.
It's like having to be an employee at a weed store. What are you talking about?
Right. Yeah, right? That's true. Good point.
Nothing would ever get done.
Cinnamon. Get to work.
Wait a minute. Who's going to announce Cinnamon? Get off of Cinnamon's lap, Gimpy. Come on.
She likes me, man.
Right.
Told me.
We're trying to pay each other's electric bills. Come on.
Predictions that were made in 1923 of what it would be like in 2023, which is, for those that don't know, you're 4 days into it. One, the workday will be only 4 hours long. Check.
Yeah, right. We got that one, don't we?
It says that because of electricity, work will only be 4 hours long.
Hmm.
That's what they said in 1823. Women will blacken their teeth and shave their heads.
Wow, I mean, there's some weirdos out there that would do that.
No.
You don't think?
No, there's no one do. There might be two.
That doesn't matter.
But it's not a thing.
Yeah. Yes.
It's now predicted that by the year 2023, only a mere little stretch of century ahead, women will probably be shaving their heads and the men will be wearing curls. Those two things are true. Also, the maids may pronounce it the height of style in personal pimping to blacken their teeth.
That's interesting.
Nope.
They had it wrong. Whiten their teeth. Yes.
Yeah, right.
Whiten their teeth. You're right. Radio. Yes. Hi. Will replace gasoline.
What?
Okay.
An expert in airlines and airplanes he predicts that by the year 2023, gasoline as a motive power will have been replaced by radio.
Okay.
And the skies will be filled with a myriad aft going over well-verified routes. So he's not wrong, by the way. This is actually happening and true.
Mm-hmm.
The belief that we just didn't understand then how radio waves would affect airplanes.
Right.
Now we know that not to be a problem unless it's your cell phone.
Turn it off.
All people will be beautiful by 2023. I present at least two cases, Your Honor.
Be nice to Lindsay.
Life expectancy will be 100 years.
What? People are dying earlier and earlier, man.
No.
Cut that in half.
No. Life expectancy will be 300 years.
Oh, Jesus.
My gosh.
People will wear kidney cozies.
A kidney cozy.
What the hell?
Yes. Kidney cozies will be worn to protect the kidneys on chilly days, just the same as a teapot in the north is kept warm by a tea cozy.
Okay. Do your kidneys get colder than the rest of your body?
No, but again, when they were doing medicine, one, there weren't doctors like what we know doctors to be now. Anybody just, people would just be like, I'm a doctor.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. And they used to drill holes in women's heads to let out demons. And they thought washing your hands meant you weren't a good doctor.
Right.
The idea was that the bloodstained hands would prove you knew how to do the work.
Right.
Exactly.
So men will curl their hair. Yeah, that's been happening for a while.
Yeah.
The old man perm.
The U.S. will have a population of 300 million.
Oh, wow.
Well, I think we surpassed that one.
Yeah. Now I have 8 billion.
Fornicating is fun.
It's in 2021, it was 331 million. So it's not a giant. It's not so far. Canada will have a population of 100 million.
Okay. I don't know what the population of Canada is, but I'm sure it's more than that.
38.2 million.
Yeah.
Utensils will be made of pulp.
Pulp. Okay.
Utensils and dwellings will be manufactured largely of pulp and cements so as to utilize vegetation and stone in every stage of decay, ordinary waste, or unfitness. I mean, it's not wrong, right? Like, a lot... MDF is a real product.
Uh-huh.
And that's pulp, essentially, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I just don't know if I want to live in a house that's made of pulp and cement.
Flights from Chicago to Hamburg will only take 18 hours.
I've never flown from Chicago to Hamburg, so I do not know.
I think it's like 8 or 10, maybe.
Okay.
Newspapers will have been out of business for 50 years.
Wow. I mean, they're half right.
Yeah.
Private kitchens will disappear.
Private kitchens.
Yeah. They're citing articles, by the way. I'm reading from an article.
Okay.
The private kitchen will disappear. Tomorrow's food will be seasoned and prepared by chemical formulas.
Hello, fresh.
Which will preserve the freshness of fruits and meats. Rid them of indigestible qualities and send them to the table ready to use. Instead of sauces that merely cozen the palate, we shall have delectable blends of concentrated vitamins, calories, ferments, and tissue tonics.
Ew.
I mean, we have all that now, right?
Yeah, we do.
Look at like Frank's.
Yeah.
That is a tissue tonic,
okay,
if you will. The tissue of your tongue.
I got it. Okay.
Cancer will be eradicated.
I wish.
Cancer, tuberculosis, infantile paralysis, locomotor ataxia, and leprosy will be eradicated.
I don't think any of those are eradicated at all. What's left?
I mean, we pretty much handled tuberculosis pretty well.
Yeah, I'm sure we got a good handle on leprosy.
I think leprosy's,
You know, but there's still places in the world. When you say eradicated, I'm thinking it's like gone completely from the world, nowhere around at all whatsoever. I'm sure there's third world countries where TB's still a thing, where leprosy's still a thing.
War will be wireless, and we might have telepathy.
I like telepathic idea, but, I mean, wireless, think about it.
War is wireless.
War is wireless, yeah.
People will communicate using watched-size radio telephones.
Wow.
Watched-size radio
telephones. I can answer the phone. Good morning, it's the Big Mad Morning Show. Giving away beer for freaking a Friday. What you need to do is answer this question. What's something you've learned in the last week? Case of Keystone Light could be yours, BMMS, and what that is to 82945.
Very good.
Jay is on the line. Hey, Jay, how are you?
Hey, buddy, how's it going?
Good, man. Jay, what's something you've learned in the last week?
I learned my wife is one of them there lizard people.
Very good. Huh. Okay, say more.
Well, we went to a doctor this week and found out she's got an ovary that she actually had removed about 4 years ago. Doctor said that if they don't get every little piece of it, then that organ can actually grow back.
Huh.
So she's not growing tails, she's not growing legs, but she's growing organs back.
Listen, I mean, you shouldn't be surprised. She grew a human in her, so.
Right.
Ain't that the truth? Her reproductive system reproduced.
Yes, it did. Right on, man. All right. Gimpy, go ahead and tell him exactly what he's going to get.
Now, I recently learned that if she says she'll cut you, she will. Even if it is for entertainment purposes only. Enjoy this case, Keystone Light. Back to you, Corbin.
Now hang on the line so Gimpy can get your info and have a fantastic week, okay?
All right, thanks, buddy.
All right, buddy, don't go anywhere. Let's see what Lindsay has for Balls to the Wall Sports.
The NASCAR Cup Series field will battle under the lights in Richmond on Sunday night for the Toyota Owners 400.
Hooray!
William Byron became the first multi-race winner of the season following a close victory in the Echo Park Automotive Grand Prix in Austin last weekend. The driver of the number 24 car has claimed a pair of first-place finishes following a Dayton 500 win last month and is sixth in the Cup Series standings. Martin Truex Jr., Ty Gibbs, Ryan Blaney, Denny Hamlin, and Kyle Larson make up the top five. The owner of the New York Jets is pushing back on a recent report. Woody Johnson used social media yesterday to rebut a claim by NFL Network that he and head coach Robert Saleh had a very heated conversation earlier this week. Johnson called the claim nonsense and absolutely false while encouraging people to disregard the irresponsible report from NFL Network. During the Around the NFL podcast, Colleen Wolf said she heard about the alleged dispute from a very reliable source. Initially, she said it occurred on Monday night, but later said it was Sunday.
Well, for him to go online and make a statement, mm-hmm. be like, end of, why would you address that?
Yeah.
Why would you, if it didn't happen, you know it didn't happen.
Mm-hmm. Especially when they weren't even giving details about what it was about. And
the if I remember right, it was about offense. He mostly talks about defense and he never talks about offense with mm-hmm. the owner. And that's clearly a problem. And the speculation being, I just don't understand why he felt the need to come out and be like, it did. If anything, it, to me, it made it valid. It happened.
Okay.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
You're a guy who has millions of dollars, probably has a couple companies, used to criticism. Why did you feel the need to come out on this?
Mm-hmm.
You could have just let it go. You and him know. You could have called him and go, hey, did you feel like we had a confrontation?
Mm-hmm.
Right? If you worry about that relationship.
Yeah.
Yeah, to me, it makes it sound like he's trying to squash it or keep his beef under wraps.
Maybe you did call him and said, hey, do you feel like we had a bad confrontation? And mm-hmm. he said, no, I don't. Well, okay, well, then I want to get in front of
but
it.
But why?
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Maybe he's sensitive.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe he is sensitive, but that's not the type of trait. He didn't apologize for any of the other things that have happened in that organization.
Right.
Yeah.
There was a sentence he said in the post, and I'm trying to remember what it said. It was something like, that's the end of it,
mm-hmm.
which I always take as a thing of like, you're full of S.
Yeah.
Okay.
Why do you need to make a definitive command like that?
Because they won't want to talk about it anymore.
And why don't they want to talk about
because
it?
Because he's embarrassed and shameful.
That it happened.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
It happened. He doesn't want to ruin their friendship.
I don't.
He's my head coach.
That man does not care about friendships. Mm-hmm. He cares about winning.
Yeah. WrestleMania 40 is going down this weekend, and reports say some pretty big names from the world of sports entertainment could be making an appearance. According to a report from PW Insider, WWE insiders have made an overture for Stone Cold Steve Austin to be involved in the festivities. In addition, there's been talk over the last week on having Hulk Hogan involved in some fashion as well.
I think some of these wrestlers, you should just let them be retired, like we'll just go with Ric Flair for one. Don't bring him back for anything except for him to go, whoo, because he can't even do that well anymore. No. You know what I mean?
It's more of a,
and Hulk is, you know, still, you know, he's still beefy and all, but man, just let them rest.
There's a couple things that I think are really interesting. One, with The Rock's appearance at 51 years of age, Stone Cold maybe coming back at damn near 60,
right,
and not in great health, right? He's doing what he can to stay active. It's not a dog on him. He's put his body through hell.
Yeah.
And you're going to have them, they're still stars.
Yes.
They still get massive pops over some of these guys that have built quite the name for themselves.
The new guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, like John Cena's of the world and
newer than that.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Right? So to me, it'll be interesting to see how that storyline plays out. Mm. Are they trying to create this lineup of older guys to come back and let this passing of the torch happen? At some point, they've got to put forgive the reference for those wrestling fans. Put a nail in the coffin
of these old guys.
Yeah, like pass the torch.
Yes.
Show that it's over.
Mm-hmm.
There was a big scene at the end of Raw where it shows them, Cody and The Rock fighting, and it goes outside into the production area where the semis are.
Okay.
And they deliberately fight in front of a semi with Stone Cold and John Cena, which they do this occasionally. Some people pick it up, some people don't.
Right.
Or it's just to, you know, light a fuse.
Right.
And nothing, it won't be anything. Because again, what are they trying to do? Sell pay-per-views.
That's it.
Sell pay-per-views. There's another wrestling story that's out there that AEW is in a ton of trouble.
Really?
Yes. They just had an event where there was less than 1,000 people at.
Oh, that's not
good. No.
No, that's not
good at all.
No, surely if they had Hulk Hogan.
Quick Army, Shirley. What?
If Hulk Hogan showed up, they wouldn't have him actually wrestle, right? Like, it would be more of he's going to hype someone.
Define wrestle, right? I mean, could he give a couple bumps? Mm-hmm. Probably.
Right. Could he take a couple? Maybe so.
Maybe.
Light bumps. Maybe a throw off, you know, onto the ropes and a sling back for maybe a clothesline. Giving a clothesline.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? But so far as like what he would be in his heyday back in the 80s when we really knew him, I don't think he'd be wrestling like that.
Yeah. To me, it's
he should be.
What is the story they're going for? The action in between and how that plays out. I've never been good at that, but I've been pretty good at trying to figure out the navigation of the story. Where are they going?
Mm-hmm.
And to me, if they bring back Hogan and Stone Cold, right? And The Rock. And Cena's always said, I'm going to keep making appearances as long as I can because this is what made me who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And Cena's got a huge beef with The Rock. Like, but there could be this thing where they pass the torch. If all these guys come back to pass the torch, that could be a huge significance. But I don't, never say never with guys leaving wrestling.
Yeah.
They could always show up. So I think it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. And Russ Cook is a runner who's on the verge of an accomplishment no one has ever done before, running the entire length of Africa. Cook has averaged a marathon a day during his 340-day journey from Cape Agulhas, South Africa, to Ras Angela, Tunisia, and has traveled over 9,600 miles through 15 countries. He's also been robbed at gunpoint and had a near-death experience in the jungle. Cook now has about 600 miles left, and his journey is complete, and he's documented every part of it on YouTube. Pretty cool guy. And that is your Balls to the Wall Sports. I'm Lindsay on 97.5. KMOD.
Balls to the Wall Sports is powered by Miller Lite, the original light beer.
Falling airplane part barely misses officer at Maine State Capitol. So police officer is lucky to be alive after he was standing just a few feet when a 6 to 7 pound steel sleeve smashed into the ground outside the main entrance of the Capitol on Friday. An officer who works as a screener to the building was walking less than 10 feet where the part fell. The FAA is investigating and says the part is likely from a large airliner on an international route, or so they'd like you to think.
Is that common for parts of planes to just fall off like that? I've seen other stories where like the landing gear fell off and, you know, ended up going through somebody's roof or something, but I feel like that's just every now and again.
This says things fall off aircraft every day. The Navy recorded an average of 460 incidents per year in the 80s. In the commercial world, Boeing received 200 reports of structural parts falling off its planes between 1989 and 1984, so a five-year period.
Okay, so in the 80s, okay, it seemed different because in the 80s, there were a lot of plane crashes, Pan Am being one of the airlines that seemed to happen to seem like they had a bunch of crashes, which I didn't think was right, but I mean, you know, whatever.
I think that the number of plane crashes every year isn't a lot.
Okay.
I could be wrong, but like, hold on, I'm getting to the 80s. We'll just go 86.
Sure.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13.
Oh, God. We're at a baker's dozen.
Yeah, but do you know how many flights there are a day?
Yeah, I'm sure there's a lot.
Thousands.
It's okay. So 13 out of 1,000, but still, man.
In a year.
Okay.
So times that by 365. That's not very many, bro.
I guess. It just seemed like
it's literally the safest way to travel.
Says you. As
not me. Parts are just data.
Falling off.
Data. Facts.
How many times you be driving down the road and something just fall off of your car?
Yeah.
It's only happened to me once.
Yeah. And then it's usually later like, where's that?
I was driving. It was a 1980 280Z. Okay. And rusted floorboards. It was a turd. I paid $700. We pulled it out of a field. Right. Well, I'm in Owosso at 86th Street, right there by the highway. Okay. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And I was going eastbound towards like the research or whatever. And I was at the stoplight and I went to take off and the car lifts up, whoop, and then boom, slams on the ground. My entire, the strut tower, the whole shebang just came right off and left me on the ground. I was like, well, that's not supposed to happen. And I got it towed out of there and got it fixed. But I'm just saying, it doesn't happen to cars all the time. Seems like it happens to planes a lot. I call this day spa or dispensary.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So basically, I've got some businesses. These are legit businesses in Tulsa.
Oh, fun.
It's either a day spa or a dispensary.
Okay.
Now, based off the name, you're going to chime in with your, and that's how you're going to buzz in. Corbin or Lindsay.
Okay. Got
it. You get one shot and one shot only because this is a 50-50 chance. There's no point in, hey, would you like to guess, Lindsay? He said it's a dispensary. No, it's a day. So you only get one shot.
Okay.
Whoever wins at the end, I got a big prize for you. Okay.
Like a little nug, maybe?
Yeah, that's what I'm over.
Maybe.
God knows you have plenty.
Right. So, day spa or dispensary, are you guys ready?
Ready.
All right, we're going to take it up from the top here. Euphora. Euphora.
Corbin,
yes.
That's a spa.
Euphora is a dispensary. No points for anybody on that one. All right, Nirvana. Day spa or dispensary? Corbin.
That is a dispensary.
Corbin would be correct.
Come on, Lindsay.
You got to get in the game, woman. Get in the game. All right. Omni Oasis, day spa or dispensary?
Lindsay.
Lindsay.
Day spa.
Day spa is correct. So far, we're tied 1-1. La Fusion, day spa or dispensary? La Fusion.
Corbin.
Corbin, yes.
That is a dispensary.
Ah, Corbin, that is incorrect. La Fusion is a day spa. Poppies. Day
Corbin.
Spa or dispensary? Corbin.
That, yes. That is a day spa.
Yes, you are correct. Poppies is a day spa. 2-1 so far. Corbin's lead. OHG, day spa or dispensary?
Lindsay. Dispensary.
That is correct.
What did you say?
OHG. That's all it is. These are all the ones. I just found them on Google.
Sure.
I just simply Googled day spa and then Googled dispensaries and then found a bunch of them that
sure.
are really close.
I just couldn't hear. I didn't hear you because you were going so fast. I didn't know it was letters.
I wonder what that stands for.
I have no idea. Nonetheless, moving forward, 918 Elevate, day spa or dispensary, 918 Elevate.
Corbin.
Corbin, yes.
Dispensary.
That is correct. Corbin's in the lead, 3-2. One Love Wellness, day spa.
Corbin.
You got to pick it up, Lindsay. Corbin, yes.
That is a dispensary.
Corbin, One Love Wellness is indeed a dispensary.
Wow.
Yes. Corbin, killing it right now.
Lotus Blossom.
Corbin.
James Bauer Dispensary. Corbin.
That is a dispensary.
Ah, you are wrong, my friend.
Well, you might need to...
Lotus okay. Blossom is a day spa. Go ahead, Google
I know there's a dispensary called Lotus.
There's one called Lotus Gold. Not Lotus Blossom. See, and that's the fun part about this game because they can be
somatic.
They're
sure.
so close. All right. Indigo, day spa or dispensary?
Lindsay.
That
is a dispensary.
Indigo. Lindsay is a day spa. So far, it's 4-2, Corbin's lead. Hand and Stone, day spa Lindsay. Or dispensary? Lindsay.
Spa.
All right. Lindsay, you are correct on a comeback.
I've been there.
It's a 50-50 guess.
Right. Of course. All right. Rosebuds, day spa or dispensary?
Lindsay. I'm going to go dispensary.
Lindsay would be correct. Rosebuds is a dispensary. Tied up 4-4. Jade Wellness Center, day spa
Corbin.
Or Lindsay. Dispensary? Corbin.
That is a wellness. Or that is a day spa.
Ah, Corbin. Jade Wellness Center is a dispensary.
What?
Still tied 4-4. Deluxe, day spa or
Corbin.
Dispensary? Corbin.
That is a spa.
Corbin, you are incorrect. Deluxe is a dispensary. Nature's Kiss.
I think that's both, actually.
Who knows? This is just the information.
Yeah, who cares if it's accurate?
Yeah. All right, Nature's Kiss, day spa or dispensary?
Corbin.
Corbin, yes.
That is a dispensary.
That is correct, my friend. Corbin just made 5-4. Aqua Viva Oasis,
Lindsay.
Day spa or dispensary? Lindsay.
Spa.
Lindsay is correct. All right, so we're tied up 5-5. Fig Medical, day spa or dispensary?
Corbin. That is a dispensary.
Nah, Corbin, that is incorrect. Fig Medical is a day spa.
I was thinking because, like, sweets,
yeah.
right? And, yeah. like, sometimes, you know, it smells like
You're
a fig.
You're thinking medical
right.
marijuana.
Right. Okay. All right. Remember, this is for a big prize at the end of the,
sure.
at the, end of the game here.
Sure.
You are going to love the prize.
Leftovers.
That
Leftovers.
Okay. Right, it's a roach.
Right. right.
Long
and
water.
Not the one you smoke.
It's the crumbs.
Laura Apothecary, day
Lindsay.
Spa or dispensary? Lindsay.
Dispensary.
Lindsay is incorrect. The Laura
spa.
Apothecary is a day spa. Lucky Garden, day spa or dispensary?
Corbin,
yes.
That's a dispensary.
Lucky Garden, Corbin, is a day spa. So far, we got 6 to Corbin and 5 to Lindsay. The Health Center, day spa or dispensary?
Corbin,
yes.
That is a dispensary.
That is correct. You sound like you've been there before.
To me, the name was just so obvious. There's
right.
no way you're going to call an actual spa that.
Right, the Health Center. Supreme Heights, day spa
Corbin.
Dispensary. Corbin.
That is a dispensary.
Corbin would be correct. All right. So we're looking at 8-5, Lindsay.
Okay.
All right. We're down in the home stretch of this thing. All right. The Enchanted Cottage, day
Corbin.
Spa dispensary. Corbin.
That is a dispensary.
Corbin is incorrect. That is a day spa.
Why are people calling here asking if we have weed?
Got any specials on an ounce, man?
It's called Enchanted.
Wildflower, day spa
Corbin.
Or dispensary?
Lindsay.
Corbin.
That is a dispensary.
That is incorrect, Corbin. Wildflower is a day spa. All right. Clover Patch Tulsa, day spa or
Lindsay.
Dispensary? Lindsay.
Dispensary.
Lindsay would be correct.
What's the score?
6-8, Corbin's
okay.
lead. All right. The Merry Mind, day spa
Lindsay.
Or dispensary? Lindsay.
Spa?
Lindsay. The Merry Mind is a dispensary. Mm-hmm. All right. The Relax Station, day spa
Corbin.
Or dispensary? Corbin.
That is a spa.
That is correct. Corbin is up 9-6. Path to Wellness, day spa or dispensary?
Lindsay.
Dispensary.
Lindsay,
Path to Wellness is a day
I'm
spa.
Sorry, I thought you said packed.
Oh, yeah.
Wellness.
Is that the problem?
No, I thought I said packed.
Sure, yes. Let me enunciate a little bit more, shall we? All right, let's see here. Heirloom, day spa or dispensary? Heirloom, day spa or dispensary?
Corbin.
Corbin.
That's a dispensary.
Corbin, Heirloom is a day spa.
Mm.
You're still in the lead 9-6. Okay.
Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show, 918-460-KMOD.
You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Good morning, Lindsay.
Good morning, Corbin. Happy 24th birthday to Arietta Adams. She gets wild and hits like...
Big Booty Showdown, Slutty Balcony Sex, and Redhead White and Blue. She was a 2020 Ravishing Redhead of the Year nominee.
Good morning, Gimpy.
You know, on TikTok, they have the video. Oh, look at my fancy butthole. That's all I see when I see her picture.
You now know what fills this timeline.
Hey, good morning. You just got a couple more days to put your vote in for the 2024 iHeartRadio Music Awards. It is the award show for the fans, by the way, but that's going down Monday, as a matter of fact. You can watch it on Fox 23. Head on over to iHeartRadio.com/awards to cast your vote right now.
All right, qualifying people for CMall 2024, and Cameron Lee of BA heard the cue and is now in the running to win concert tickets to every concert KMOD is a part of, including VIP Week in Rocklahoma tickets that will be announcing Rocklahoma very soon. Qualify every hour with us, so your next chance with us will be Monday, but Mel and J-Rod have chances as well, and the first cue with Mel is right before Audio Slave, just after 11 o'clock. It's all from Yuengling and America's Oldest Brewery, Tulsa's Rock Station, 97.5 KMOD. Let's do some willy-nilly. Anything you want to talk about, bring up something new, go back to something, it's completely up to you. And so a couple things for willy-nilly. I got Hulk Hogan is going to be at WrestleMania. He is at the fan event that they do, where he'll be signing autographs, so it doesn't necessarily mean he'll be involved.
Gotcha, but he will be there at this place.
He will be in Philadelphia.
Okay.
So, is there a possibility? Sure. No guarantee. The other one, I think this is bigger. Brock Lesnar's back on the roster.
Really?
They're showing him on the roster page.
Wasn't he in some trouble not too long ago?
They believe he's the unnamed person in the Vince McMahon lawsuit.
Oh.
Yeah. Unnamed former MMA current wrestler.
Right.
Right, which was felt easy to put together. That also could involve Bobby Lashley, by the way, who also did MMA and what's it, CM Punk. And so it could be, but it felt like everybody felt like it was Brock Lesnar. Nonetheless, he's back on the roster, which I think there's a high probability you see him at WrestleMania.
Oh, yeah.
So in that world, I think it's going to be big.
Yeah.
The other thing that I just saw is they have announced some rules, apparently, for the Paul Tyson fight.
Oh.
Okay.
Fighters over the age of 36 must successfully complete an EEG and an EKG to detect if there are heart or brain problems.
Okay, that makes sense.
Both fighters will wear 16-ounce gloves, which is different than the normal 10-ounce gloves. And 16-ounce gloves are usually what people wear for sparring. They're bigger and heavier. It slows punches down dramatically. They're easier to block. So the idea is, I think this will make it a little bit easier. But if you don't go sparring and then doing a full fight with heavier gloves, it's a lot, man.
Yeah, yeah.
So we'll see how that plays out. Rounds will be scheduled with a duration of 2 minutes rather than the regular 3 minutes.
Okay.
No official judges will score the fight. Therefore, no winner unless a KO.
Okay, so basically they're just boxing each other for fun, and nobody gets to take any bragging rights, quote unquote, unless somebody gets knocked the F out.
Yeah, it feels more like an exhibition.
Okay.
Without saying the word exhibition.
Right, we're doing this for the money.
Yes, and I think this is a sparring session.
Think so?
That's what you do in sparring.
Yeah.
You don't score a spot when you spar.
True that.
And if someone gets knocked out, it's over.
Right. The question is, who's going to get knocked out?
I don't think anybody.
You don't think so? They're just going to drag it out just for entertainment purposes?
I don't think they're going to drag it out. I think Tyson 100% has the power to knock somebody out.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
I hope Absolutely. He does.
I know. But he definitely has the power. But with the heavier glove, it could slow him down a lot. And it might be enough slowdown for Paul to get out of the way.
Okay.
He's going to have to catch Paul completely off guard. 2 minutes is not very long.
No, it's not.
Not in a fight. I know.
Two minutes is long enough, Corbin.
It is long enough. I'm just telling you that if they're real, it depends. If Paul is like, all I'm going to do is evade, he might not get hit.
Right.
If Tyson comes out like, I just want to be a bull in a china closet, I think he might tire himself out.
Maybe so.
Maybe so. Any of you guys plan on watching or just catch the highlights?
Absolutely not. I am not paying for a pay-per-view.
If someone, someone I know is buying it and they say, hey, come on over and watch it, then maybe, yeah.
Right.
I think when they do that, you're being expected to chip in.
And that's on Netflix, right?
Oh, yeah, that's on Netflix. That's going to be on Netflix.
I believe it's still going to be a pay-per-view, though.
Oh. Yeah.
If it's free on Netflix, I'll watch.
Yeah.
Right on. Something I might have to check in.
I am not paying extra.
Yeah.
I can get the highlights the next day. There is no sense of I can follow on Twitter to find out what happens.
Right.
Hell, if it's on Netflix and I don't have to pay extra, I'll have a party and we can all watch it at my house.
Why would I go to your house to watch a fight that's going to happen at 11 p.m. when I can sit in my bed and do it?
Yeah, that's fine.
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
The reason you get together is because someone's paying for it, right? You don't have to pay as much.
Right. Right. Maybe there'll be a bar or something around town broadcasting. Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. Okay. Lindsay, this question is for you.
Oh, right.
Where do you find cheap boys' clothes for your kids?
Oh, Uptown Resale Shop in Broken Arrow, 91st and Elm. They have good quality stuff. Or if you have a problem with buying used, Ross. Ross is the place. And I like the one on 71st Street.
If you like shopping in war zones, yes. And you want to take 45 minutes to check out, yes. If you want one sleeve longer than the other, yes. If you want a third button where it doesn't belong, yes.
Or
one arm that's longer than the other.
Hey. Old Navy. Old Navy. Because you get the Old Navy bucks, too.
We'll say Kohl's. What about Kohl's Cash?
No, I don't know if they do Kohl's Cash
anymore.
They do. They still do? Yeah, I don't know.
You're sleeping on Kohl's, girl.
Yeah.
Kohl's is where it's at.
I feel like I end up spending way too much there.
You say that at about almost everywhere you shop.
No, just Target. That's why I don't shop at Target.
Costco.
Yeah, well, you have to overspend at Costco because you're buying in bulk.
Some other text coming in. What question has been asked so much it makes you want to roll your eyes now, Lindsay?
I don't know. There's a lot of them. Too many. Too many to know.
I gotta be honest. I don't think you've been here long enough to answer that question.
That's fair.
That's fair. Yeah.
I'm not saying you can't have one you're annoyed with, but 2 years?
Three. Coming up on three.
Yeah, I know. Gimpy.
Hey, how come y'all don't play some of that old stuff with Biggie on it?
Okay.
Yeah, that one gets a lot. And I'm like, it's been how many years since he's been on the show? Yeah, come on, man.
I would say, if you didn't get into radio, what would you do?
That was another one. Right?
Willy Nilly, something for Corby. The Queen, MLK, and Annette. Let me try that again. Something for Corby, the Queen, MLK, and Anne Frank. They wrote Annette.
I like Annette.
We're all love at the same time. We're all, I'm sure they meant born at the same time. The Queen was only 3 years older than MLK and Anne. Then the Queen wasn't born at the same time. MLK was born the same year as Anne Frank.
Right, right.
Well, this is the same generation.
Whatever.
Tyson Paul fight is free to Netflix subscribers. Okay.
Free.
Has anyone watched Quiet on the Set? I'm curious if you guys think the parents were negligent. Lindsay.
I have not yet watched it. It is on my to-do list. I'll probably watch it next week when my company leaves.
Gimby.
I have not. That's on Max, right? HBO Max?
Sure.
I think so. I haven't watched it yet. I've seen some of the clips and stuff on the TikTok. So I guess technically I have watched a little bit of it, but not enough to form an opinion. I could easily say, yes, the parents were negligent because the parents would see dollar signs and their kid out there being stars and not really care what they got to do to get to that point and to get that money. So I would, in my own personal opinion, not really watching the whole thing, I would say, yes, the parents were negligent.
Yeah, I have not watched it either. I know the gist of it. And 100%, I would say the parents take some sort of responsibility. Negligent, maybe. But they definitely need to take some responsibility on what happened to their child, too. Why did they? That is not a normal environment for a child.
No, yeah. It's not.
And for you to put your guard down and just trust strangers who want money, I think is not the right avenue. I'm sure they were like, he was like family. He would say things like that. And it was definitely at a time when we, when people weren't as aware of predators.
Right.
So I guess there's something there.
I did see yesterday, though, that there was three or possibly even five producers at Nickelodeon, and one was a talent coach, one was a producer, and one was a writer, that they were all at one time convicted of being a pedophile. One was a child molester at one point, arrested. They all had criminal records of indecency with children.
Yeah, I don't know that.
Working for Nickelodeon.
But Nickelodeon goes, we hire, you know, Lindsay's production company. We have no idea that we don't check the employees you hire as the production company. Right?
Crazy.
So who knows what happened with that? But that would be, that's insane.
Yeah.
The other thing, too, that is bizarre about that, and I encourage everybody to go look this up. And I don't know if it's true. I just saw it online. Probably fake. The comparison between what Epstein Island looks like and the Nickelodeon logo.
Okay. Yeah.
Go look it up if you haven't seen it. It is very interesting. If you died, did you find it gimpy?
Yeah. Yeah, sure enough.
If you died, what kind of weird instruction or clauses would you like to put in your will just to mess with your heirs? Lindsay.
I don't know. I would hope that my kids would have to stay close.
You don't really mean that. You don't really mean that. You want them to hinder their life goals and the things they want to do for your last wishes?
I don't mean like stay close as in like they have to live in the same state, but just stay close, stay in touch.
What if one of them bangs the other's wife?
Okay.
You want them to stay close?
Yeah, no.
What if one of them accidentally kills someone?
Accidentally kill someone?
Whatever. Yeah. There's no way to know.
Yeah. Depends on why they did it. I don't know. I don't ever want them to lose touch with each other.
Gimpy.
I am going to say that you have to keep all of my stuff, and because it's my parents' stuff as well. When they died, I got all their stuff and my grandparents' stuff, right? So all this garbage that I've collected over the years and kept, they have to keep all of it.
On display.
I'm talking to Avon bottles, you know, all those little knickknacks in the curio cabinet from my ma, all that stuff. And then everything that I own just as well.
So you can't have your own stuff.
Well, you can still have your own stuff.
I don't know where.
I don't know where, but...
Have you seen how many Avon bottles you have?
You have to get a storefront and put the stuff on display.
Start a museum.
Right.
Yeah. Mine is you're going to have to go on a treasure hunt every year on my birthday.
That's fun.
Do you have maps? I mean,
a little autonomy is okay. Unlike you two, I'll give them some autonomy.
I have a question for Willy Nilly. When it comes to the cargo ship that crashed into the Francis Scott Key Bridge, why did President Biden assure us that we were going to pay to have it rebuilt? Wouldn't it be the responsibility of the insurance company of the ship
to pay for it? Absolutely not.
Why not?
Well, because it's a foreign ship.
Okay.
We ain't got paid nothing.
How do you know if they even have insurance?
Still, their government probably should have put up the cash then.
Yeah.
No, that's not how it works. That's not how the industry works. So that's one part. There's a thing called the Jones Act. Go look it up. It's an outdated act. It creates many problems. The other thing is that is one of the biggest, if not the biggest, port in America.
Mm-hmm.
You will see the price of cars increase dramatically because of how many cars go through that port every day. So every day that it's not open and every day that all that's happening and people can't, it creates a massive, people are going to lose their jobs because they're going to close those ports as long as it takes to rebuild that bridge. So what do you do? The government has a responsibility to get that infrastructure back up as fast as possible. I don't like the idea that we have to pay for it, but we need a solution pretty fast.
Well, you know, the top 1% is, you know, got $44 trillion apparently, so let them pay for it. But instead, Joe Blow, like us, has to pay for it with our tax dollars.
I mean, yes, we have to pay for it ultimately, but it isn't like, you know, our price is going up.
So then, okay, we pay for it, and then could we go after that company later once it's done and get reimbursed?
So you're asking me if another foreign country or foreign business would have to show up in an American court?
Sure.
I think you know the answer to that. The answer's no, right?
Well, I'm going to go put my name on that son of a bitch then.
On what?
On the bridge after it's rebuilt. I own part of it. I'm going to put my name on there.
Sure.
And then I'm going to take it with me.
If you could switch your legs with any animal's legs, which animal would you choose? Lindsay.
A flamingo, because they're nice and skinny. They're long and skinny. I've always wanted longer legs and skinny ones.
Why not a giraffe?
They look pretty skinny.
Oh, but then I'd be really tall.
Have you seen their tongue, though?
It's gray.
It's purple.
Oh, purple.
What do you learn? You would have got
guessed
shocked
gray.
Again.
Yeah.
Don't blame me for your question. Don't blame me for your misstep. Gimpy.
That is a damn tough question because not all animal legs are sexy. And I'm not going for like the flamingo legs. I think I would pick that simply because they bend backwards. Not for the skinniness of them, but for the oddity of them, right? Giraffe legs, super long. The first thing that popped into my mind was kangaroo, but then I'd be forced to hop everywhere I go, which I guess wouldn't be too bad, I guess, but I don't know about all that. So, and then you don't want something like a shrew or mice legs, right? Because they're just too small. They're too small. So any animal. I'm going with Homo sapien.
Which is what you have.
Exactly.
So that's not switching then.
If I switch with somebody else's legs, like let's just say I switch
Kate
legs
Upton.
With Lindsay or Kate Upton's legs. Yeah.
Nicole Richie.
Right.
I'm picking a duck, man. Ducks walk funny. I love the idea of the versatility of it.
Okay. Make swimming easier.
Yeah. 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 I can stay on top of the water.
Right. It just, I mean, you already waddle everywhere you go.
Amen. Right. Why not finish the job?
Right.
Have you all watched the comedy Roadhouse? I'm assuming they're talking about the Jake Gyllenhaal, Conor McGregor movie that I don't believe is a comedy. I have not watched it, Lindsay.
I have watched it.
And is it a comedy?
It has some funny moments. I wouldn't necessarily call it a comedy. It's good. We liked it. Kevin and I watched it. We liked it. Conor McGregor is no actor.
What's good about it?
The fight scenes are good. It does. It follows the same sort of script as the original. And Jake Gyllenhaal, I mean, he is a badass. He plays a good badass. And he is ripped in this movie. Which you have to be, you know, because Patrick Swayze was. They do not, spoiler alert, they do not rip out anyone's throat in this movie, but they do have a throat scene.
I've seen that movie before.
Yeah, right? Yeah. It's pretty good. I would have been disappointed if they would have released it in movie theaters, though. So I am glad that it went to home. To Prime or whatever. It's worth a watch.
Gimby.
I haven't watched it. I have no intentions in watching it because I think it's going to ruin the first one. And I don't want that to happen. The original Roadhouse is badass. So I don't want to know. I'm good. Good.
I have not watched it. I doubt I'm going to seek it out. And I don't believe it's comedy. How about this? Who would win in a three-way fight? Gimpy, 12 hours after ingesting 550 hits of LSD.
That's a lot of acid.
Lindsay, 12 hours after downing a liter of tequila or Corbin 12 hours after completing a triathlon? Lindsay.
Well, how long does LSD stay in your system?
Months.
Okay.
Months, months, months.
Yeah, let's
especially
go ahead.
Especially 550 hits. You're probably talking like 3-4 months maybe. Mm.
All right, so I'm going to say, even though a triathlon is going to be an excruciating, leave you in excruciating pain probably, you work out on a reg, so your 12 hours of sleep, you're going to be pretty rested. So I'm going to give it to Corbin because you will be still rested. A liter of tequila, even after 12 hours of sleep, I'm still going to be probably hungover. And LSD, Nope.
So you're going with?
You.
Okay, Gimpy.
I think that I'll still be in the corner rocking back and forth after 12 hours after ingesting 550 hits of LSD, so I'm out on that one. Corbin, I think, is going to still be a little sore, a little tired. Yeah, it's 12 hours. Yeah, he might be a little rested, have gotten some sleep, but I think he's still going to be sore after that. So I'm going to give it to Lindsay because 12 hours after downing a liter of tequila, okay, she might be a little hungover, but it ain't going to slow her down any, I don't think.
So I think the 12 hours after ingesting 550 hits of LSD, Gimpy will still be fighting imaginary flies around him. Or hiding from whoever's hunting him.
Yeah.
Or writing a beautiful operatic rock album.
Right.
And I think 12 hours after downing a liter of tequila, I don't disagree, Gimpy. I think there is enough time to replenish electrolytes, eat a Subway sandwich. You know what I mean? Get some rest.
Yeah.
Take a B12. There might be some ability to come back from that.
Mm-hmm.
12 hours after completing a triathlon, I think that's also enough time to recover, if not fully. If you've been training correctly, you could recover 100%.
Okay.
So I think percentage-wise of recovery, I think the best bet would be either the tequila or the triathlon. I'm going to go with triathlon. You can't really train for drinking a handle of tequila, but right. You can train. You know how to maybe recover afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
So putting ability to fight aside, I think recovery is what we're talking about. Yeah, that's fun. All right, we're giving away beer. What's something you've learned in the last week? A case of Keystone Light, BMMS, and what that is to 82945.
Let's rock. More of the Big Mad Morning Show is next.
Never seen this before. It has a name. It's called a Godemeki.
Godemeki.
And it's a tube. It's got threads for you where you can hold it. Like laces almost, like a football. And then the inside's dimply.
Yeah.
A steel faux foxtail plug.
Okay. Those tails are nothing new.
No, but this one looks exactly like a tail.
Oh, my goodness.
A corn on the cob vibrator.
Corn on the cob for the country girl.
It's gone.
It's got the
juice.
I'll
tell you all about it.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I thought when I saw it.
Corn on the cob. I gotta look.
Yeah. It makes sense if you think about the attachments that are with it.
Oh, God.
You know what I mean? Like the dimpling and bumps and all that other stuff.
Usually dimpling and bumps is not something you want to mess with, right?
Right.
You need to go see a doctor and get those bumps removed.
Some of you may have grandparents that have special china and some case in the dining room that's white with blue patterns on it.
Yeah.
The blue willow china?
Sure. This is a butt plug that looks like that.
Oh, my goodness.
Honey, it's special anniversary night. Break out the fine china.
Yeah.
Another one, the penguin.
Uh-oh.
And it looks like a penguin whistling. And the part that would be the mouth of the penguin would apparently be where the magic happens for ladies.
The Satisfier Penguin. Oh, hey, look at that. A little bow tie and everything.
The Nerd Climax Dragon Finger. Wow. This is a sex toy that goes on your finger, and it is the shape or has the look of a like a dragon's claw. That's hey, so listen, weird. Lid for every pot, whatever you got.
What?
When we were in school, we had a thing. There were like these rubber balls with handles, and you would jump on them, right? And you would have races with them.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is that, except it is for the ladies.
That's so weird.
It's a Swiss ball dildo. This is Gimby has shown me the one he has before, which I ran. And this is the Accommodator.
The Accommodator.
You know,
huh?
if you're familiar with that chin strap.
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, you do. And then probably the mildest one on this list would be the Clone a Willy dildo kit.
Oh, yeah. I've seen those before.
Pretty mild.
Yeah. Thought about using it, you know.
I don't know how it would work.
What do you mean?
So if you ever made, have you ever seen like the, in Hobby Lobby, they have those plaster Paris where you make the plaster Paris of like you holding your baby's
absolutely.
Hand or like you put your kid's foot in it.
Yeah. I did that in art class with my little hand. I know exactly what you're talking about. Mm-hmm.
That would be this, except it comes in a tube. And the idea is you do what you have to do and then you do the mold and then it sets and then you, I don't one. Hair.
Yeah.
Two, any sort of deviation from what's happening in a sexual moment for me, it's over.
Right. Mm-hmm. So your dildo would come out all weird and deformed, pretty much, basically.
Or smaller than the representation.
Well, what am I going to do with this thing, huh?
And do you tell people it didn't work? Like, I couldn't do it?
That's why you read the reviews first, right?
And I don't know anybody that's done it, so I can't. I know they sell them.
Oh yeah.
So I'm sure someone's gonna be like, "Oh yeah, it was great."
I'll get one over the weekend. Put one together. Bring it in for you Monday.
You don't have to bring it in. You can just give me the verbal review.
Drunk Florida man kicked out of bar, returns and attacks bar owner with belt. This happened last weekend in West Palm Beach. A 37-year-old man kicked out of the bar for being too intoxicated, but quickly returned wielding a firearm, according to an affidavit. Fabio Lano Sanchez, arrested by Palm Beach Sheriff's Office. According to records, he was released on last Wednesday with a $60,000 bond amount. He arrived to the area on July 23rd around 2 a.m. The owner of the bar said that he shows up. He was a little drunk. Then he got too drunk and he started harassing customers. So they asked the man to leave. He left to his car, but came back with a firearm. He pointed it directly at the bar owner and said, "I will shoot you." And then he threatened to shoot the bar's security. Well, then Sanchez decided, "I'm going to just take off my belt," and started swinging it at the bar owner. He hit him multiple times. A security guard began fighting with the suspect, and the bar owner began fearing for his life. He told deputies that that's when he called 911, and they showed up, arrested him, said he was going to kill everybody. The owner had an injury on his finger from the belt. The guy himself did not have any injuries. The suspect had some scrapes and bruises on his face in his mugshot, though.
That's a very underrated weapon.
Absolutely.
A belt is, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, you could do some damage with a belt. Trust me, I know. But to use it in like a street fight, it's not something you see every day. You hear about guns, knives, crowbars, baseball bats. I appreciate this guy for whipping out his belt.
Yeah, if you're good, like that whole towel whip, you know, that people, if you can do that with a belt.
You could whip the S out of somebody. And you don't even have to towel whip them with it. You could whip them like a slave.
Uh-huh.
Crap. you know, right across the face. That's going to
hurt. Get the buckle.
Oh, well, the buckle's good for handle.
Oh, that's true.
I guess I think of the scene from Indiana Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
When Jones is in the street and the guy is the sword and he goes,
he's all over here.
And he just pulls out his gun and shoots him.
Right.
So.
Well, everybody knows you don't bring a belt to a gunfight. However.
Apparently you do.
The owner didn't have a gun.
One of them had a gun, right?
Yeah, the bad guy had a gun, but he decided not to use the gun. I'm going to go a little bit lighter. I'm going to take my belt off and whoop him like a stepkid. Quote unquote, push Christian woman arrested at a splash park. This happens in Ohio, where cops were called out to the Cedar Point Shores Water Park there in Sandusky. All right. They say that a woman that describes herself as a Christian and a grandmother was arrested because witnesses told her that she called a child a brat, a fat ass, and then pushed him off a floating toy.
I mean, brat.
Right.
Fat ass. Good morning. It's the Big Mad Morning Show. 918-460-KMOD. You can also text BMMS and then what you want to say to 82945. Giving away beer for friggin' A Friday.
Friggin' A Friday.
Been asking people all day what's something you've learned this week. Briley? Is that right?
That is correct.
Sorry. Hey, Briley, how are you? Good, man. Briley, what's something you've learned this week?
Well, going on one of those rabbit hole dives of, I found that there's a plant in Australia called a gimpy gimpy. And if you get close to the plant, it'll, when you breathe it in, it actually can cause nosebleeds and cause you go into certain types of cardiac arrest. And if you actually touch the plant, whatever you touch the plant at, it'll feel like a burning sensation, either for anywhere between 30 minutes to a month.
Yeah, this says it makes you feel electrocuted and set on fire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Awesome.
How did you find this? Like, what were you looking up that caused this?
Australia.
Okay.
Australia's it's always been one of those things I always wanted to go to. And looking up everything about it. So it's pretty cool. You can actually eat the fruit that the plant produces if you take the hairs off of it.
Sure.
Shave your fruit before you eat it.
Nice.
All right, Gimpy, go ahead and tell him exactly what he's going to get.
You know, Lindsay recently learned how to tell a story in a timely manner. Just kidding. It still takes 3 days. Have a case of Keystone Light. Back to you guys.
Hang on the line so Gimpy can get your personal info and have a fantastic weekend.
Stay right there.
Well, bye.
Yeah. Sure. I'm sure there are many dangerous plants out there.
They say that Australia is home of some of the world's most deadliest and dangerous plants and animals, which is another reason why I don't want to go. I don't want to go.
Oh, man, I would go to Australia in a second.
Yeah, but what would you get out in the outback and out in the bush?
Yeah.
And like... I mean, I get it. It sounds cool, and I'm sure it's beautiful down there. I got a friend down there who who's just got married in Australia. She'll be coming back at the end of this month or whatever. And beautiful pictures. Looks like she had a great time. But I don't know if I want to have to worry about, you know, small animals that could kill me
Sleep. That happens here.
I guess, maybe. I feel safe when I go camping, like go out to the lake, you know. I don't feel like there's anything that's going to attack me. I mean, I know there could be, you know, bobcats or something like that that could potentially, or mountain lions or something. But it seems like everywhere you go in Australia, there's a deadly spider that wants to kill you. There's a snake that wants to eat your face off. And apparently a plant that makes you feel like you're electrocuted.
And a kangaroo that likes to kick your ass.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I think... as long as I'm winning like a guided tour, like with people that know the land, I ain't gonna go wander.
You ain't gonna walk about?
No. But yeah, I would love to see some of those things.
If that's the case, then yeah, all right, cool. You know, guided tours. I've always thought a safari, an African safari, would be 100%, awesome,
but not by yourself.
No.
Oh. With someone that knows the land. Even those, have you seen the one where they're on this guided tour and the elephant picks up the Jeep and you're like, well, that doesn't look like what I experienced before.
See, and that's a whole nother reason why not to mess with that stuff, because elephants don't give a damn about you and your feelings, and they don't sure as hell don't give a damn about that big-ass truck or bus that they were in. No. No, and that's the last thing I need is an elephant stampede coming towards me while I'm trying to stamp a picture.
Yeah, normally you're into that. In that video, it's so amazing because the driver's just like, eh.
He's yelling at him like, ah, no.
Move on.
Right.
It's very reminiscent of that video from maybe a couple years back of the, was it a hippo that was trying to climb over the fence and the guy's slapping the hippo in the face? Like, get down. And you're like, go on, buddy, don't anger it.
Right. It is the deadliest animal, one of them, in the whole world.
Yeah, yeah.
No, thank you.
Yeah.
I choose to view my wild animals through a glass or a cage sort of thing.
But I got to be honest, this is quite shocking coming from you. You are the, who was the guy that would go on the Johnny Carson show with all the animals?
Yeah.
So you're that guy of the show. You have more animals of diversity than anyone else.
That is a very true statement.
That's just in his house.
I've got ferrets. I've had snake before. I've got dogs, and I've got all these. I've got an iguana. Lizard, yeah. The difference between those animals that are in my house right now and the ones you find in anywhere, mine are domesticated, and I only feel like I have to worry about them harming me after I die. You know what I'm saying? Like a cat will eat you. If you die at home, a cat will eat you instantly.
Yeah, I'm the one that has to worry.
There's no waiting. A dog will wait for at least, 30 days or until it's really, 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 really hungry before they start eating you. Cats don't give an F. They'll just jump right in and start gnawing down. When it comes to the ferrets, I'm not quite sure because they're like part cat, part dog. They're cat dog. You know what I mean? And I hope that they take the dog side at that and they give me some time before they start eating my flesh after I pass. But you put out in the wild, you're sitting there, you're sleeping, you're in your hammock. You're like, oh, this is great. I'm in Australia. I'm in Africa. And next thing you know, a goddamn leopard's coming down from the tree that you got your hammock tied to, and it wants to eat your face.
Yeah, the word domesticated is just a word we use to justify keeping those things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There's no, to say domesticated is like,
yeah, I agree with that.
The ferret ain't sitting.
True. I mean, I haven't messed with a whole lot. As a matter of fact, none at all. Wild ferrets. I've seen some polecats, wild ferrets. I tried to go after it, but they're squirrely little sumbitches and ran away. But I'm good.
Yeah, good. I think the likelihood of the three of us to be eaten in our homes definitely lands with Gimpy, Lindsay, then myself. I think that I am very safe. Nobody is eating me in my house.
Until they turn into zombies.
Yeah, that's not a thing, though. So until it is, right. I feel really safe coming in third place on that.
Absolutely. I think Lindsay would be the first one to go be eaten in her home if she died. And simply because she only has Bruce the fat-ass cat.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, cats won't wait. I've got three dogs. They're going to wait for a while.
Mm.
The ferrets, one, they stay caged up unless I let them out to roam around and play in their room or whatever. And hopefully I don't die after that day. Okay. And they're still out roaming around. And the same way with the iguana. Well, two things with the iguana. One, they're herbivores. They don't eat meat. Okay. And then two,
there's plenty of plants in you.
Right. He's like, smells like a plant.
I'm just saying, you're right. She definitely has the cat. I agree with what you're saying on that. But you have a mutiny.
That is true. If they all just rose up and said, you know what? F it.
They have a house meeting after you die.
Right.
On the couch. And they're like, what are we going to do? And they're like, well, he ain't getting any healthier.
Yeah. Right.
We got to eat him before he spoils.
Right.
All right. We got to take a break. We'll be back.
More of the Big Man Morning.
Cops get there. Dave's at a stoplight. Still on his phone. Not paying any damn attention. So light turns green. The guy behind him honks his horn. And Dave's like, what the hell, man? And they start yelling back and forth. They take off eventually. Well, while they're driving down the road, old Dave starts throwing stuff at the truck that's behind him that honks horn at him, yelling and cursing, rabble, rabble, rabble. They get to the next stoplight, and when they get to the stoplight, that's when Dave gets out with a can of white spray paint, and he uses that to go spray paint the face of the driver behind him that he's fighting with, along with his truck, you know, spray paint his car, and then use that same can of spray paint to break the back window. There you go. So then the guy that honked his horn at him, it's not sure. Nobody really knows what happened here, whether he had his own can of white spray paint or he used the same can of white spray paint. But he goes and takes a can of white spray paint and sprays Dave's face with it. So now you got these two people pissed off at each other, white face spray painted, right? Cops eventually come out. They determined that Dave was the asshole aggressor in this one, and they took him in for felony criminal mischief.
What?
Yeah,
the pictures are amazing.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
I don't get it.
How do you get that close to somebody that can spray paint you?
Right. I guess he did
that good.
Right. Didn't think he was going to do anything about it. You know, people get mad. They get all up in your face. And you know, but if I see somebody coming at me with a can of spray paint, that's a weapon at that point.
Listen, yeah. I could see it like you're going to get like part of my face or on the side or something. But they look like they've been antiqued.
Yeah, it's awesome.
So I don't know, like how the
maybe had a wide nozzle on it. You know, that kind of sprays broadly.
They have a pill for that. Yeah,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Dude, the heat's got everybody acting crazy.
Oh, I'm telling you,
that is those pictures are unbelievable, man. They are some of the more spectacular photos we've had in a while. Italian cheesemaker dies after being crushed by rounds of cheese. An Italian cheesemaker is dead. He got crushed by all the cheese on the wall. That takes a whole new effect of cheese off the cracker, right? The man was checking on his cheese in the warehouse. It's unclear how the first collapse that triggered the domino effect occurred. There were 10 corridors of shelves that stretched floor to ceiling with about 1,600 rounds of cheese per corridor. It took rescuers 11 hours to find the 74-year-old man's body underneath all the cheese. Each wheel weighs about 45 pounds.
Damn.
Of Gran Padano.
Wow.
Damn.
How about that, though?
Crushed by cheese.
Not that dough. Cheese.
How about he died doing what he loved?
Sure he did.
This is the way.
The cheesiest way to die ever.
It does. It is a stinky way to die. Yes,
I'm telling you.
That cheese ain't cheap either.
Right.
No.
It's like $1,000 a wheel.
Damn.
Wow.
Yeah.
So we got crushed by what? A couple $100,000.
I mean, 1,600 rounds of cheese.
Yeah.
And I don't know. Is that cheese ruined? Can you sell that cheese after it kills someone?
Not the ones on the very bottom of the pile,
yeah,
I imagine.
Yeah, but the ones on the top, yeah, probably.
Yeah, like let's just say there's like a layer of cheese on top of the dude.
Mm-hmm.
Anything after that first layer, I think, is good to resell.
So, but does it add a value to it? Like, this cheese here, this cheese fell on the man, the cheesemaker, and killed him.
Right.
Oh, I can taste the sadness.
Yeah.
Right.
I can taste like the life transferred to him, the cheese from him to the cheese.
Just cheese smells like death.
Have you ever been into like a cheese house?
No, I don't think so. Mm-mm.
You would remember.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, a house made completely of cheese. I would.
Well, no, not like it's not like the butter exhibit at the fair,
right?
No, like a fromage, like a place where they sell like that's all they sell.
Worst smelling house ever.
They have sliding glass doors for each of the rooms of cheese because it's so pungent.
Mm-hmm. Oh man! And you know, sometimes you work at places and you take that smell home with you. You know, like if you work at the dump or you know, as a trash man, you smell like garbage. You know, imagine coming home and smelling like stinky foot cheese every day.
So I'm listening to this podcast and they're talking about your senses or whatever. And anyway, that you don't know what your house smells like, right?
Right.
Is what they talk. You have no idea.
Mm-hmm.
And that to you, it smells good or nice or whatever, comfortable. But to a stranger, they may come in and go, oh, God, their house stinks.
Mm-hmm.
Does that hold true with somebody who works in a cheese place? Like, they're like, this smells great. Hey, it smells a little off in here. No, it always smells off in here.
Yeah.
Because you have moldy milk.
I would think that like everywhere you go, everything smells like cheese. It's just permeated in your sinuses.
It's just burning.
Yeah. So everywhere you go smells like cheese. Because like, I don't know anything smells like. It just smells like Parmesan to me or whatever.
Some cheeses, I actually like super stinky cheeses.
Right?
Yeah. The taste.
And the smell. Yeah, I love it. Mm-hmm. I think it's amazing. It's amazing that we're eating it. It's amazing someone went, let's put this in my mouth,
right?
That's it's amazing. Just the historical factors around the process and to have super stinky cheese. And then there's cheese not stinky at all that also tastes great.
Right, right.
So the smell plays no part in it.
Yeah.
I think cheese is amazing.
It's so good.
Yes, it is.
Things that garbage collectors find in the trash. And it made me think twice. Maybe in some instances, we actually could get into that line of work.
Good morning. It's the Big Man Morning Show, 918-460-KMOD. Don't forget, just after 11 with Mel, listen for that audio slave. Get you qualified for CMall 2024, brought to you by Yuengling, America's oldest brewing, Tulsa's Rock Station, 97.5 KMOD. Lindsay, what'd you learn today?
I learned, of course, Corbin would go to Australia and experience the outback and bush. Nothing he hasn't been in before. And Gimpy the plant have a lot of similarities. Yeah. After it's shaved, you can ingest it. And if they poke you, you're left with a burning sensation.
Hey.
It's getting cleared up. Gimby, what'd you learn today?
Well, I learned you don't have to shave all your fruit before you eat it. There's nothing wrong with eating a hairy peach. And I also learned that just because she tells you she's fixed doesn't necessarily mean she is. That stuff grows back.
I also wrote down, it's not just the plant that does that. And I also learned just now that it's been 6 days since the Chiefs traded L'Jarius Sneed to the Titans.
Mm-hmm.
And neither team ever acknowledged the trade.
Whoa.
And he's still on the Chiefs roster.
Mm.
Interesting, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's Corbin saying, make sure that dishwasher is loaded right.
It's Lindsay. Stop tracking my cycle.
This is Gimpy. And I'm sorry.
He ever saw working as a garbage man was a coworker who regularly ate and drank things that they found in the trash. Yes. Yes. One man said, my dad did the recycling run in the rich parts of town. People would throw away brand new, still in boxes, like wine glasses, shoes, and things like that. We would resell the stuff online and make a few hundred bucks a month. That's pretty cool.
Throwing away brand new shoes.
Maybe they were the wrong size and... I don't have the time to return these. Trash them.
Sure.
I don't know. I would ever do.
They were a gift, and maybe somebody's got some beef against that brand or whatever. Like, these Adidas are trash.
Or they only wore them a few times, and they took really good care of them, and they still looked new. Ashes of the deceased. One time we found someone's ashes